Let's call this meeting to order. This is the September 9th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Hempfling.
Here.
Also present are Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, Chief of Police Dave Hale, and from Coolidge Wall, Jessica Brockman.
Okay. First order of business is announcements. I always look to Mr. Hausch for having plenty of announcements.
That's right. And actually, Patty stacked up a few more. I guess let's try to do these in order. So on Wednesday, and this was also in the packet, I thought it would be good to let everybody know, if you don't already, that you can meet the new Antioch College president, Tom Manley. That's from 5 to 7 at the Herndon Gallery. On Thursday, the 22nd, we will be doing the groundbreaking for the new water plant. That's out at 640 Jacoby Road at 11 o'clock. We also will be having a ribbon cutting for the new playground right here at the Bryan Center, or definitely new equipment and mulching and all that. That is the 28th, so the following Wednesday at 3 o'clock. And I also wanted to mention on September 21st as well, it's September 27th. Fourth Tuesdays of every month is when the food bank truck comes to the Bryan Center. And this one is special in that they offer fresh produce and baked goods, and that's from 1 to 2 o'clock.
Okay.
I think that's it.
Anyone else?
Yes, I have one. Want to just thank everybody for the words of encouragement, cards of sympathy, and so forth for both myself and the family during our loss. Thank you again.
And we are very sorry, Jerry, for your loss. I do have one announcement. Books and beer. The Green County Library, well, it's Green County Libraries, it's actually the Dolly Parton project, is having a fundraiser here in Yellow Springs on October 3rd, starting at 5:30. And all of the money goes to the Dolly Parton Project, which puts books in the hands of children under 5 years old. As of now, in Green County, over 4,000 children are enrolled. They have given away 113,770 books, and over 2,000 children have actually moved through the program. So it's an incredible program. Admission is $25. All that money goes to Dolly Parton Project, so please support that. It happens to be before a council meeting, so you might have to choose. I know I will.
And
Oh, it's at the Yellow Springs Brewery.
Oh, okay.
And I did want to mention one more thing. I think everybody may know that the first presidential debate is on Monday, and the Little Art Theater is doing a special event from 3 to 7. It's kind of open hours to watch pre-debate programming, and also Think TV has a series on the presidents that they'll be broadcasting. And then I think it is mostly full, but you can check. There is going to be a debate watch party I guess that'll start at 8 o'clock.
So the circus begins.
Yes.
Okay, do we have any Board or Commission members to swear in today? Oh, yep. John. Yep. Wonderful. Do we have, where's the?
There should have been one at your spot.
Okay, it is. It's here. It is here.
Judith, would you like to swear in?
Oh, sure. All right. Commission member. So just repeat after me. I solemnly swear or affirm that I will support the Constitution.
I solemnly swear or affirm that I will solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws of the United States and the state of Ohio.
And will obey the laws of the United States and the state of Ohio.
That I will, in all respects, observe the provisions of the Charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
That I will, in all respects, observe the provisions of the Charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
And will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of members, board member to the Justice System Task Force.
And will faithfully discharge the duties of board member of the Village Justice System Task Force.
That's it. Congratulations.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
And that's not your first time, I don't think, officially serving. You served on the Visioning Task Force, didn't you?
Yes.
So, welcome back.
Thanks.
Next is the consent agenda. We have the minutes of the September 6th regular meeting and the financials for August. Thank you for those, Melissa. Can I get a motion, please?
I move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay. And something I learned, that even if you aren't at a meeting, you don't have to abstain. So, but I typically do if I'm not at a meeting. Next, we have a review of the agenda. Any items that we want to add, remove, or relocate on the agenda?
Yes, I have a couple questions. One,
sure.
I noticed that commission reports weren't included.
Eek!
And the reason why I'm bringing that up is because I did include a draft ordinance from the Environmental Commission.
Right.
For just any comments.
And yeah, I'm not, that got past all of us, and I really apologize. Maybe at some point you could kind of, you could find an old one that has the list so that we could.
I can pull one up.
Go through, okay. So just so we can read through it when we get to that point. So that happens after clerk's report, right? Commission reports.
Yeah. And the other thing was, we received a packet about community development funding, but it wasn't on the agenda.
Yes.
Good point.
I think Patty's going to talk about it during her manager's report. Is that right?
Which one are you talking
about? Your, the event.
Oh,
community,
yes.
Community development,
yes.
Funding?
Yes. Yes.
During, okay.
What's happening to it?
She will talk about it during her manager's report.
Oh,
okay. Let's see. Anything else? Okay. Brian, will you review the petitions and communications we received?
Yes. So we received a letter from Anna McClure, who I guess it was Les Groby's idea that she wanted to bring forward about a proposal for Short Street to have car parking on one side, bike parking on the other, and make it a one-way street to improve traffic flow. Dino Pallotta sent in a letter related to the moratorium on development, specifically, development with the formerly known land CBE, and suggested that the grant should be used for those utilities. There was the petition about moving the stop signs on the High Street, which I believe we're going to talk about. The chief also included a memo, and that's in Patty's manager report. And Demi Reber did a follow-up about the village not vacating the alleyways. Her thought was that this is a good way to preserve green space. I mentioned the invitation for Tom Manley's meet and greet. The water plant groundbreaking we've talked about, and then we also had the announcement for the Miami Valley Cycling Summit, which is going to be May 5th of 2017. That's an all-day Friday event.
At Wright State. So the reason it's important to us this time around, it's every 2 years, is that it's the first time it's been in Greene County. So we're very excited about it.
Is there a place we can talk about the alleys?
We can add that to
new business.
I was going to say, there's two requests. Aren't these coming to council from Planning Commission?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. So I just was going to say.
Talk about.
And is that related to the alleys situation?
Mm-hmm. There are two.
Well, there are two specific vacating.
Oh, so that's
requests,
the.
So I didn't know.
That's probably what it's in relation.
No.
No?
There was a specific situation in that two alleys were given, were vacated by the Planning Commission. A larger discussion ensued about, let's take an assessment of all the alleys and decide, can some of them be put on a list for kind of front-of-the-line alley vacation, which is much further down the road and which is not specifically to do with the two alleys that you will see as ordinances coming up, because that was a larger conversation that went forward. So I don't think it's pressing.
Well, I would like to have some time, whether it's at this meeting or another meeting, to talk about alleys in general, and at least my thought about what I'd like to see Planning Commission do in that regard. So I don't know when.
Maybe we can do that during during the Planning Commission review time.
Okay. At this meeting.
So you're suggesting that before they develop legislation to bring to us, that you would prefer having a discussion here?
Yes.
Okay.
About any particular alleys, but
alleys in general.
Yes.
So just to clarify, you're not saying hold up the legislation for the two individuals who have already
Correct.
Received permission. Thank you.
So let's do something. Let's. I'm going to pencil that in into future agenda items.
Okay.
Alleys.
But I'm confused. The two requests, do they come to council?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. No, because I just heard Judy say that they had gotten permission, so I just...
They received preliminary permission.
There's a recommendation. Okay.
Okay. Speaking of Planning Commission, we have a lot of zoning code ordinances to read. We'll read those all in by title only. Judy, we'll start with the first one.
All right, this is second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-17, repealing section 1262.08 specific requirements of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1262.08 specific requirements, adding mobile food trucks to the I-1 and correcting a typographical error.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, I think this is, the title pretty much tells it, but Patty, would you just review?
Yes, this is one of the oversights when the zoning code was actually printed. There was a meeting on June 12th of 2013 in which the council actually added food trucks to both the I-1 and I-2 zoning areas as a conditional use. However, in the code, it was only listed in the I-2. So this corrects that typographical oversight.
Okay. This is the second reading of this ordinance, and I will open the public hearing for public comment. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Hempling.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Wintrop.
Yes. 2016-18.
This is repealing section 1248.03, spatial requirements of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1248.03, spatial requirements, correcting an erroneous density maximum of 14 units per acre in RB to a maximum of 8 units per acre in RB.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
If you look in the narrative for the purpose in the RB moderate density residential district, it lists development at 8 densities of up to 8 units per acre. However, if you look further down in the spatial requirements, it relates to it at 14 acres per unit. This just corrects it to the intended 8 units per acre.
Okay. Any questions? This is a public hearing. I will open the floor for comments. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hempling.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Wintrop.
Yes. Second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-19.
This is repealing section 1258.01 district uses of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1258.01 district uses, adding mobile food trucks to the EI district.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Patty?
Again, it was an oversight. Mobile vending trucks were allowed in several other districts. There was a request from Antioch that it be considered to be permitted in the EI district. These minutes are from July the 10th, 2013. The council did pass it in that particular meeting, and it was just... they neglected to put it into the conditional uses.
Okay. This is a public hearing. I will open the public hearing for comment. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Hempling?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. And second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-20.
Yes, this is repealing appendix zoning map entitled for zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new appendix zoning map, correcting a typographical error to list educational institution correctly as EI.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
It says E1 instead of EI, so someone read the I as a 1 and put it in there as a 1. So we just need to correct it to educational institution.
And it's still very difficult to differentiate that.
It is.
I think, yeah, education institutional, I think if you think of that as opposed to a numbered zone. So I will open the public hearing for comment. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Hempling?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Couch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Resolution 2016-45.
Do you want this in full?
Yeah, just go ahead and read it.
All right, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a contract with Design 9 Broadband Planners for a fiber needs assessment and business plan. Whereas the village sought proposals for the completion of a fiber needs assessment and the development of a fiber utility business plan for the village, and whereas the village received 6 responses as a result of that effort, and whereas upon careful consideration of the proposals by the village manager's fiber advisory board, tabulation of the reviews by the board's individual members, reference checks, and extended discussion, the proposal submitted by Design 9 Broadband Planners was considered to be the lowest and best proposal. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, that, Section 1, the village manager is authorized to enter into a contract with Design 9 Broadband Planners to complete the Village of Yellow Springs fiber needs assessment and business plan. Section 2, the amount of that contract shall be $48,500. Section 3, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
We did let the RFP for the needs assessment, and I see Scott Fife here tonight. Scott is a member of the Fiber Advisory Board as well. We did get 6 responses. This not only was the lowest, but the board feels like it will meet our needs quite well. I had estimated about $60,000 for this, and all of the other ones were $60,000 or higher. So this actually came in quite a bit lower, and we were very satisfied with the information that they're going to provide us, as well as the reference checks and the discussion that we had was pretty protracted. So, Scott, did you want to add anything?
What kind of a time frame are we?
They're still trying to stick to the time frame that we gave them, which is to have it done by the end of the year. We might be a little bit behind at this point because we delayed 2 weeks because we wanted to get more information. But at this point, we think we can still get it done as fairly quickly.
And what about the grant? Did we hear anything?
I have not heard anything further from the Community Foundation. I did contact them and let them know that we were going to probably let this contract tonight and what it was going to cost, but I haven't heard back from them yet.
And which what budget is this coming out of? What fund did it say in here?
Melissa?
Probably administration.
Just general fund administration?
Mm-hmm. It'll be a supplemental appropriation once I know the firm amount.
Okay, any other questions or comments from council? Questions or comments from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 And finally, resolution 2015-49.
And title only, or?
Is that a long one? No, why don't you just go ahead and read that?
Sure, this is authorizing the village manager to amend the contract with Shook Construction Company for the design and construction of the water treatment plant to reflect the guaranteed maximum price. Whereas Village Council desires to construct a new water plant to include iron and manganese removal and pellet softening for the Village of Yellow Springs, the project. And whereas Council previously authorized the Village Manager to enter into a contract with Shook Construction Company to design and construct the project. And whereas the contract with Shook Construction Company must now be amended to reflect a guaranteed maximum price in accordance with the process of a design, build, construction project. Now therefore be it resolved by the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio that, Section 1, the village manager is authorized to amend the contract with Shook Construction Company to reflect a guaranteed maximum price for the project.
Section 2, said guaranteed maximum price for the project shall be $7,196,608, as reflected in attachment A, which is not attached here because it's gigantic, but is available. Section 3, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So we went into great detail on this bid. We had representatives from Shook at the last meeting, and we went into great detail, went reviewing through the bid, through the proposal, the cost proposal. This is a guaranteed maximum, which indicates that there is still an opportunity for it to actually reduce. Right. And I tried to make it clear, and I think Patty and the water department will continue to make it clear that anything that can be done to reduce this price would be appreciated. We did one question from the last meeting was whether we would include demo of the existing filter building. This particular contract does include that. I don't know if questions had been sufficiently answered.
The reason that I went ahead and put it in the price is because if council chooses to not move forward with the demolition of the existing plant, we can do it as a deduct. But in that case, the cost goes down, and it's always better for the cost to go down than the cost to go up. So I just went ahead and had them include the $51,393 in this price. So if we choose to not demolish it, we'll just deduct it off of there and the price will go down. If we choose to go ahead and do it, it's already in there and we don't have to worry about adding it and the price going up.
Did there happen to be any discussion among Shook and the staff or about the possibility of keeping the building and what it might be used for?
We did discuss it at a couple of meetings, and honestly, we couldn't. The shape that it's in, we couldn't come up with anything that we thought was a logical use. We talked about storage of some kind. We talked about keeping it as some kind of an office space. It's just not really built for anything else other than to be a water plant. So
I talked to a couple people at what's it called, Zero Waste Network. Is that what it's called?
Mm-hmm. The Yellow Springs Resilience Network or the Zero Waste Group?
The Zero Waste Group.
Zero Waste Group. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I put some feelers out to them regarding any use they could see for it or in terms of what we do with the waste so that it's not just becoming part of the landfill. Mm-hmm. So just so we're not at all tied into that in case, I don't know if they'll come up with anything, but I thought they were the people who would be able to think about that question.
Yeah, part of the problem is that it's going to be in a restricted area because the new plant is going to be built right next to it. So it can't be used for something that gets regular public access. But anything, if they come up with something, that's great, then we can reuse it. We couldn't think of anything.
Or even what happens to the waste.
To the waste is good.
Well,
yeah.
It's going to fill in the...
Oh, so they will use it as fill, so it'll be on-site fill, which is pretty good use.
I don't understand.
Essentially, that building is a big crater. Essentially, that building is a big crater because you have the filters up here and the sand beds down here, and it's just a big crater with equipment in it. So we would remove the equipment, probably scrap that, and then the demo from the building would be to fill it in.
And then it would be covered over with...
Because in particular, there are those two big pits that are...
Right.
I consider this a big moment. We've been working on this for a long time, and I think a lot of energy, a lot of time, and thoughtfulness has gone into this. So I think it's something that the community should be pleased with, that we're finally addressing the water plant that is over 50 years old and in very much in need of replacement. So any comments or questions? Any other comments or questions from council, from the community? Rick?
I just have a quick question. I'm not too
Can you familiar.
Just
state your name?
Pardon?
State your name.
Rick Donahoe. Yeah. There's no chance of using this for some kind of a
backup or something like that?
No, it's we're actually getting a redundant plant. So within the plant itself, we'll have redundant systems. So it will be able to essentially run two separate systems as it is. Mm-hmm. And just the idea of trying to maintain two plants would be very difficult.
This plant, the existing plant, would need millions of dollars worth of upgrades just to make it viable to keep running in the near future. But yeah, the new plant will have two 500,000 gallon a day redundant pathways. So we'll be able to generate a million gallons a day if we need it, but the plan is to use them alternatively, and so that neither one of them gets a lot of wear and the maintenance is a lot easier to do.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thanks, Rick.
There have been years of discussion about this, but there's been a lot of discussion about the old plant and what could be done, and then what happens is one piece breaks, as has happened about once a year for the last couple of years, and then you have to put in lots of money. So we need something that works.
Yeah. Any other comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask that you come to the podium, state your name, and keep your remarks to 3 minutes. Bill?
Hi, my name's William Firestone, and I would like to talk about issues of trust, integrity, public officials, and the appearance of impropriety. And what I would like to do is read to you from your own documents, and I would like to start with the document December 2nd, 2005 from Coolidge Wall, and it's addressed to Councilmember Karen Wintrow, and it's legal opinion 2005-08, Conflicts of Interest Guidelines. Dear Karen, John Chambers requested I respond to your conflict of interest inquiry about various affiliations you and your husband hold that could impact your actions as a council member. This letter will provide you a summary on the application of Ohio ethics laws with respect to conflicts of interest and offer you some guidelines regarding how you must respond to certain issues before council. And section 102.03 fundamentally prohibits the use of public office for personal gain. And I would go on to talk about, in addition to your affiliations, you stated your husband, Ted, holds the following affiliations that may impact your role on council. Number one, the Center for Business and Education. Ted is engaged as the architect for the project being constructed by CBE. CBE is a learning center that is intended to serve as a gathering place for development, attract speakers, and facilitate professional growth. The village is participating in the development of the CBE. Under section 102.03, participating in discussions or voting regarding funding of the CBE project would be prohibited during the time your husband is performing services as the architect. His agreement is a thing of value that affects your joint personal pecuniary interests. Okay, now I'd like to skip to another topic, which is, as I was looking through numbers and the purchase orders and all these payouts, basically, to Ted Donnell and to the other firms that he runs, I came across this number, $50,000. I thought, what is this $50,000 number on this purchase order from 10/17/2012? And it said, Engineering Northern Gateway. I thought, $50,000, there must be an extra zero in there. Do we really spend $50,000 on engineering services for a project that never even broke ground? You can answer that question. So anyway, I went further into it, and we go to the Yellow Springs Library Commission, March 10th, 2009, where a discussion begins about how there needs to be a professional evaluation of the library building systems. Somebody suggested Ed would contact Richard Lubinsky, who did an energy audit at the Bryan Center, and Ed will also contact Lawrence and Williams, architects, designers of the new LEED certified Girl Scout building in Dayton, about the building systems audit. And then we go on to July 7th, 2009, where we learn that Ed has one proposal in hand, one on the way, and one other to be arranged. Instead of presenting them all to the commission as a whole, Ed and Connie will review them, and Catherine Vanderheiden will be involved by way of counsel.
I'll give you 30 more seconds.
Okay. So what happens is we end up having two bidders for this project, one who submits before the qualifications are even released. His name is Ted Donnell, and he bid $21,000. Another architecture firm from Dayton, whose name I won't give for privacy reasons, bid $15,610. Okay. So then they move forward. I think my time's about up, but what ends up happening is there's about a year and a half process whereby the village goes back to Coolidge and Wall to find out, well, how can we hire this guy who's married to a public official, but is also a public official, a Board of Zoning Appeals member, is considered a public official, under and is bound by the same ethics laws as an elected public official. And so I'll continue this discussion at a further time. Thank you.
Thank you.
For your forbearance.
Any other comments? During this time, thank you. We don't have any special reports, old business.
Open for comments on CBE?
No, we're actually getting to that as a discussion item.
I guess I would just like.
It's not on the agenda.
Is it on the agenda?
It is on the agenda.
There's no word CBE anywhere on the agenda.
I believe that is because.
Bill, stop. We don't take comments from the floor. Marianne.
Well, if a citizen has a serious intention of bringing up issues of malpractice or conflict of interest or whatever, I suggest that it be done in writing, with the evidence in writing, because while it's sort of sensational to stand up and talk about it, it's very difficult to actually take in the information when it's being spoken. So that's my suggestion.
Sure.
And we can certainly have our attorney, who is sitting here, look at, you know, whatever information is brought.
Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll move on. Old business. At the last meeting, we had a discussion item, or actually we had a piece of legislation that was the RFP for the Center for Business and Education for taking infrastructure to the area from the intersection of Dayton Yellow Springs Road and East Enon to the entrance area of that property. We decided to keep it on the agenda. There citizens did present to us an initiative, paperwork for an initiative, that there be a moratorium on development. There were a lot of questions. We got into a discussion with our attorney and decided at agenda planning last Monday that we would actually take it off out of legislation, and we would make it an agenda item under old business. And it's the Dayton Yellow Springs Road infrastructure RFP discussion is what that is. And so I think the first order of business is to talk. We did what we asked of our attorney is to, and there have been communications back and forth between Dawn Johnson and our clerk, whose responsibility it is to, what's the word you would use, Judy?
You determine the validity of the initiative. Just, is it valid on its face so that it can go on to the Board of Elections?
So they've been working back and forth, and I know that Judy worked quite a bit with Dawn to straighten that out. We did get a legal opinion from Coolidge Wall, and Jessica is here to present that.
So as you all know, this involves a complicated factual background, but fundamentally the village entered into a contract back in 2006 with the Army Corps of Engineers. At that time, legislation was passed to approve the contract and authorize the village manager to sign that contract. The village has performed on that contract and expended funds in that process. Those funds were expended with the understanding that the village would receive reimbursement. Failing to perform under the terms of the contract would be a breach and would be a violation of law. If the village is put in a situation where the contract is breached, reimbursement of the funds that have already been expended, which I believe is around $140,000, would be at risk. The rights of initiative and referendum are guaranteed by the Ohio Constitution and the village charter. However, not all actions of council or any other legislative body are subject to initiative or referendum. I can cite the case law, but in essence, if the action is legislative, then it is subject to initiative and referendum. And if the action is administrative, then it is not. An action is legislative if a law, ordinance, or regulation is being enacted. It is administrative if it merely involves the execution or administration of a law, ordinance, or regulation that is already in place. An act that carries out policy that has already been declared by the council is considered to be an administrative action and therefore not subject to an initiative. Chris and I have looked into this issue, and it is our opinion that the village's actions at this point are administrative. The village would be in violation of the law based on breach of contract if it does not move forward with the amended scope with the Army Corps of Engineers. The reason is that in 2006 and 2007, legislation was approved without challenge, and the village is now merely taking steps to administer the contract with that amended scope. The referendum in November of 2014, was to determine if there should be an further expenditure of public funds. That referendum was soundly defeated, which meant that citizens did not want to spend additional public funds. The scope of the contract was, based on my understanding, amended to not require the expenditure of additional public funds and is therefore not contrary to what the referendum held. Council's actions are administrative because the village is merely administrating a contract that has been in place for over 9 years and instructing the village to move forward and complete the infrastructure, which it is contractually bound to do. And therefore, it's administrative, not subject to initiative.
Okay. So is the council clear on?
No.
Okay.
Can you just summarize it quick?
So it's, you're saying it's administrative.
Because we're just.
No, wait, let me finish. Sorry. So when council passes legislation, that can be administrative.
It's not that you pass legislation, it's that you're really going back to that original contract from 2006. That's what makes it administrative, not that you pass legislation.
I think
I'm talking about the current legislation that's, you know,
yes,
has been discussed.
Yes, it can be in that sense, yes. Because you're just administering on that previous contract. Is that what you were thinking, Patty?
Well, I think what Jessica is saying is because back in 2009, council passed legislation and that legislation has already been acted upon. And the fact that we're rescoping, you're saying
that doesn't change.
It continues that administrative action. No,
yes.
We're talking about.
So
the
why do we bother to vote?
We're talking about the infrastructure grant right now.
I don't understand why we would vote.
And not the.
We're just talking about the infrastructure grant. Yes.
Yeah, I'm asking why would council vote on it if actually their vote doesn't mean anything?
You're still administering that by voting on it. You're just not creating new legislation.
But I guess my question is, so if we vote no, we're violating the contract? It sounded like it from what you were saying,
no.
That if we would vote no to this, that we would be violating the contract. So then I don't know what the point would be of voting.
Is the...
I'm just trying to understand.
No,
I'm
yeah.
not, I don't...
Let me ask you.
Yeah.
If I understand it, what we're voting on is to, what we are voting on is to amend the initial contract that we had, which said that we would go through and install the infrastructure within the CBE. The village came forward when we decided to do that, and through a referendum, if I'm correct, soundly, said no, you will not spend any additional money to complete the infrastructure.
Yes.
Okay. We still have a contract in place that says we basically have expended some funds, engineering, and so forth. And what we're saying is we would like to use those additional the funds that we still have on that contract to just run the infrastructure up to the edge of what was known as the CBE. And in doing that, we would not be in any violation of the contract that is presently enforced. And if we were not to do that, then we could be in default of that contract, which would put the funds that we have already expended that would be reimbursed to us in jeopardy.
Yes.
Is that, that's what I'm understanding.
I think the previous legislation from last week was just amending it, so.
Correct.
If it doesn't get amended, then you have that original contract.
Then we're back to the original.
Then you're back to the original.
We would have to determine to do something with those funds.
Yes.
Or we're in jeopardy of losing our reimbursement.
And it's possible that you could, they could come and sue for more as well.
They could come back for damages.
Yes.
Possible.
Yes, it's possible.
And I think, I mean, this essentially relates to citizen rights, to referendum and initiative.
Yeah, not about, yeah, it's just about initiative and referendum.
Okay. You know, go ahead.
I don't like getting this at a meeting. I would like to have this kind of, I don't like, you know, being presented with this kind of information at a meeting and not having seen it ahead of time. I just want to say that. It's somewhat complicated. You know, I don't like to get things unexpected at a council meeting. I want to be prepared to respond
right.
to it. So I don't appreciate that. I'm sorry to say.
I don't think it's.
It's not you. Maybe it's not your fault, but I don't know. I'm just saying to whoever is, you know, I'm just saying. I like to be able to see what we have to deal with at a council meeting ahead of time so I can be prepared.
But I think, if I'm correct, a citizen presented a document that suggested that a referendum or
initiative
should come forward against the vote that was taken to extend the infrastructure forward.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What I just heard from you, and that's in response to the initiatives that we got late in the package that the village manager requested a legal opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And your response is the legal opinion on that initiative,
mm-hmm.
okay, which should be presented in public,
yeah.
if I'm correct.
Well, so. Jessica's report is in response to council's request for legal counsel to bring back more information
right.
that was made at the last meeting us back.
Yeah, I don't know that there are any decisions that need to be made tonight. I mean, there's certainly you know, other discussion, and we don't have any legislation on the agenda, and it is a lot to digest. There are people here to talk about it, I'm sure. You know, ideas, I think that you know, the idea that there be a public process, I think that's potentially something that we can talk about as some kind of a public process to hear ideas about development on the property itself. You know, I would like to separate the infrastructure discussion from the development of the property itself. because getting the infrastructure to that site is really necessary for anything that's done on that site. We have the money, we have the grant, and it wouldn't require any additional funds from the village in order to install that infrastructure. You know, I don't know what our deadline is from the Army Corps. I don't think anybody will know. I think that they know that we're interested in moving forward on that. I'm guessing that they wouldn't expect us to have anything done before the construction season of 2017. So I think we have some time to consider that, some time to talk to the community, and some time to start a public process.
I kind of agree with you, Karen. I think that we should separate the two. The discussion on the CBE and the discussion on the infrastructure. I think those should be two separate discussions because as we talk about this, what was formerly known as the CBE, and it's now, if, and I missed part of the last meeting, but it's my understanding that we now, the village, has somewhat agreed to take possession of that property.
Well,
what is the status?
We're still working on the paperwork. The actual paperwork was turned over to Community Resources for their legal to review it, and maybe Dino can tell us where that stands. I'm not sure. We were hoping to close later this week, but depending on where their status is, and we're still trying to lay our hands on one document from the original CBE folks, that the member who we think has it, the former member we think has it, is out of town. But as soon as their review is done, if they're satisfied with the documents and we can find that one remaining document that we need, then we will close as soon as that happens. Dino, do you agree with that?
Okay. So given that, and I think I agree with the public, that should now start a new discussion on that land, you know, with public input and so forth. So I'm all full of that, you know. But I think as we're going through the process, it has to come to us first, and we do owe the public that opportunity to discuss now what we're going to do with it, whether it be this council or a future council. So.
Well, I do see extending the infrastructure as being distinct from planning and working on the property, which has no name at this point. At the same time, I believe that there are people probably in this room who don't see it as separate. And so I think, at least for this meeting, when we open this up to the public, I suggest that we let people talk, whether they want to talk about the infrastructure on Dayton Street or they want to talk about the land that was the former CBE or whatever. I would suggest we just let people talk about whatever they want to, because otherwise they're not going to feel like they have a chance to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's I agree. I would agree with that, absolutely. Any other comments from council before we do open up the floor?
I said early on that if we were going to go forward with the infrastructure, which I do not think is distinct from development, you don't need that infrastructure if you're intending to keep that land as farmland. That's the one instance in which the infrastructure does not make sense to put in, because you don't need that infrastructure. I felt that if we were going to go forward with it, you know, because preserving the Jacoby Greenbelt to me is essential for the village, you know, for what the village people want. We want that preserved. So I had a conversation today with a citizen who basically made the argument, which was a concern to me, that extending the infrastructure will make it more difficult to preserve the Jacoby Greenbelt, and the reason being that it will increase the value of the properties that are just down the road from the former CBE land, the CBE land. If that's true, which I don't know if it's true or not, but if it is true, then that's a significant concern for me, because we don't want to see, I don't want to see, and I don't think most of the villagers want to see development beyond the CBE. So that's a question I would want an answer to. Is it going to make it more difficult because it's going to increase the value of the land beyond, because they're now closer to access to utilities? So that's one question. And I asked, and I know Melissa sent it to us, the council, but citizens haven't had a chance to look at it, I don't believe. Is it out on the table? A question I had asked about, you know, part of the argument, there's two arguments that I've had, you know, that I have felt were strong arguments, but then I started thinking, well, we need more detail. One of those was that development of more business development on that land would make the village more affordable. It would make utilities, which are
high because we don't have enough people tied into them, enough businesses and citizens and individuals, that it would make it more affordable. So to get some sense of, is it really going to give people relief, some kind of relief in terms of the cost of their utilities and so on? And then another issue is environmental, you know, the fact that more people can work here, so they're not driving out of the village. That's another kind of question. And then the third thing was businesses in the village that are growing, that they would have to leave the village. So that's a concern. So all three of those things are concerns. But the preservation of the Jacoby Greenbelt and whether, and, you know, I feel like if we're going to go forward with the infrastructure, that we need to have a very strong commitment and a strong plan. And so the question of, is it going to make it more difficult to do it, makes me feel like we need to know the answer to that. I would want to know the answer to that before making a decision on this infrastructure.
I would think Krista would be a good person to ask. I have had a conversation with her mm-hmm. about that. And
we have her coming to the, I was going to propose that we have her come to the October 3rd meeting. She's available. Okay. Yeah, for that meeting.
But I can say that, I mean, she and I talked about both preserving the Jacoby Greenbelt and that property. She never mentioned that as an issue, but we can certainly.
I found one document that's part of the comprehensive plan, and that's our urban service boundary, which basically says how far we can extend utilities and still be served by gravity sewer, and it essentially goes to the edge of the CBE property. So that's one mark that basically says that's the end of where we're going to serve, where we're going to take utility extensions. We've got to be worried about what's happening coming our direction from Fairborn. You know, so I think that's. So the buffer we need is at that Jacoby Greenbelt and is at that property that starts to the west of the Center for Business and Education. And personally, I think if we use resources to save, you know, this piece of property, then we're using resources that we could be using for much more valuable pieces of property for the village. And this is truly the only direction that we can go. I think it's the preferable direction to go for development, for business development, of which we desperately need it. Brian, did you have some?
No, I think we've covered it.
Okay.
I have a few things to say, but I guess I'd like to hear from citizens.
So, well,
I'd also like to point out that it's my understanding that council is not, that the general feeling of the village is to not annex any further out.
Right.
And therefore, you're not going to extend your sewers outside your municipal boundaries anyway. The only reason we did it for Morris Bean was because it could potentially affect our well field. That would not be the case in the land west of this property,
right?
Which I recommend we call Lot A, just for the sake of simplification, because everybody doesn't know what to call it.
That's true, Lot A. Okay, we'll open the public discussion. Why am I going
Kat.
Blank?
Kat.
Thank
Hi.
You.
I'm Kat Walter. I live at 535 Fairfield Pike. Thank you. I've been thinking about this a little bit, and it's timely because I've been talking to some folks about what's going on with the Lot A area. The issue of the future of that land is contentious because villagers care, right? It's been on the ballot. We've heard lots of arguments. But I really do think it's in all villagers' interest to do what's best for the village, right? We understand that they care. I think it would seem that many who want the moratorium or those who want no growth at all, there is a fear that the space will be temporarily occupied by any type of chain store, right? We've heard that argument. Without long-term interest in the village, in an economically viable village, I think creating a nurturing, resilient community requires a sustaining economic base in which a higher number of villagers need to be able to participate. We need jobs. There's no doubt about that. And how we go about it, I think, is really the key. How much space we have to develop which types of jobs. So along these lines, I think current needs are that we're not meeting in the village to become more, not completely self-sufficient, but more self-sufficient to be able to withstand future ecological, energy, economic, and equity crises, and the last being led to because of the previous three, exacerbated by them. We had a smart growth envisioning process in 2009, and one of the presenters, Michael Schumann, did a workshop called Going Local in Yellow Springs, and they had discussions, recommendations for developing a stronger economic community that is also more resilient. There is a PDF on the village site, which is very informative, with his recommendations, some of which I believe the village has put into play, either through the council or not. And I guess I'm curious, are there recommendations in that PDF that we could look at for development there, if that's the way that we go? And also, I think a couple of you have alluded to a public forum that, you know, village would oversee, but where you have more input from the village, people maybe who haven't spoken up, and there's a time limit, right? There are specific parameters for people to really be able to engage in a discussion beyond the shorter time limits in a council meeting. So I look forward to seeing this move forward.
Thanks, Kat.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kat.
Anyone else? Dale?
Dale Hotaling, a resident of Yellow Springs for over 50 years. I'd like to speak about two core values of Yellow Springs that I'm aware of from all the years that I've been here. One of them is including the town in crucial, important decisions such as this, not just deciding it with a small group of people, but including the whole town. We've talked a little bit tonight about what the village wants, and when there was a referendum 2 years ago, the village voted against development on that land. It wasn't simply the finances, because I know I voted in that election and I wasn't voting simply against the finances of that land. I was voting against it being quote-unquote developed. I do see it as part of the other core value of Yellow Springs, and that is preserving green space. We know this is not the most easily economical place to live. We've chosen to live here. Businesses know that. We need to be creative about how we use existing buildings and existing spaces in terms of attracting businesses and things like that. But in terms of using that, and I do see, Jerry, that the infrastructure is tied to the development, because once the infrastructure is there, it's just a very simple leap to start plowing land and building there, which I personally don't want to see. But what I do want to see is I want to see the town weigh in on it, not people saying the village wants this, the village wants that. I want it on the ballot, a firm plan of what it's going to look like out there, what the development's going to look like, and then let the town vote on it rather than a small handful of people deciding that. I feel that that's opposed to one of the core values of Yellow Springs in terms of being an inclusive, collaborative community that we come to solutions and ideas together. And deciding it here with maybe three people voting for it and two people not objecting to it or something, it is not part of the fabric of Yellow Springs as I understand it. Having it on the ballot, clearly defined what the proposal is, and then seeing what the village says. If the village says, yes, we see this as an economic boon, we want this, you know, I might vote against it, but I support that. If it's decided in this room that we're going to, you know, run utilities out there and eventually have buildings and bulldozers and things out there without really hearing from the village, I do not support that.
Thank you,
Dale.
Thank you. Dan?
Hi, I'm Dan Reyes. I want to try to speak to, I may have missed a little bit of the opening of this, but what I heard of the special report and then this idea of whether the issue
from
of the... Okay. And the issue of whether this these two items, the utilities and the eventual disposition or use of that land are connected. I guess I'm inclined to say that this isn't even so much a concern, that second issue. It's not even so much a matter of what one wishes to see with that land. I've myself wanted to hold off really even thinking hard about that till it becomes publicly held, the property out there, what its best use is. But I am a little surprised about trying to do the infrastructure first. And I could say that there's maybe philosophical reasons for keeping them connected, but also practical ones. And I think this is maybe what brings us back to the recommendations that you've gotten from council about how to act responsibly as a folks that take care of the business of the village. That looking at both of these together seems to me to improve the chances of having a good match between the infrastructure and the use of the land. And the infrastructure isn't just one thing. And we've seen examples of this in the village unrelated to that, even in recent years, as the village has spent good bits of money to adjust and repair infrastructure that did not suit actual development, that did not match up with needs. The bottleneck project, for instance, was $800,000 to basically make a planning adjustment. That that's more complicated than what we're talking about here. But it's an example where infrastructure not matching use actually ends up costing money. So in these regards, it seems to me that it's worth spending at least a little bit of time to study the use of this property and to be able to coordinate that with the infrastructure that you may or may not want to put in there to have an appropriate match between the two. It's not a matter of do it or don't do it, it's just the timing. The plan and the solution for the support, the infrastructure support for that plan, ideally should go along with each other. And this is a case where there's every opportunity to do that. That, nothing's been done yet. So there's a chance to take a few moments to study this, to look at the prospective uses, to weigh benefits in relation to the community, and also look at impacts in respect to what sort of infrastructure they do or don't call for. Thanks.
Thanks, Dan. Anyone else? Bob, did you want to speak?
That's not okay. Mm-hmm. First of all, give me some extra time. My two ears are 166 years old between them. Do your own damn math. When I watch you on Channel 5, which is my entertainment, every 2 weeks sometime, and when I can't take it any longer, I come down my old truck and we talk. But anyway, I cannot hear Channel 5. I have missed 30% of what was said tonight. So someone, somewhere has to monitor the level for old geezers like me so we can hear. Okay, that's number one. CBE has become a contentious thing, it really has. I voted against it 2 years ago when we were talking about infrastructure and spending money. Infrastructure to me is bricks and mortar. Now maybe that's not your interpretation of infrastructure, but it's mine. What we're talking about here is extending utilities with a grant. Now, my first question is, what is, I've got it in my pocket. I've got a comment from the 8 September Yellowspring News from Patty and Van Zant that they want to reduce the scope of the USACOE. I don't know what that is. Is that the 200?
Army Corps of Engineers.
Okay. United States Army okay. Corps of Engineers.
Now I know that. Will the 260,000 cover bringing water, sewer, and electricity?
Water, sewer, and stormwater.
Okay, but not electricity. Let okay. DPN worry about that, or the village.
Well, the village okay. would come right. in on I got the back. You. But.
We are not talking about bricks and mortar. We're not talking about a big expense. We are talking about no expense. And I think it would be very short-sighted to turn down a free grant to bring water, sewer, and trash. Now, it's our hope sometime. First of all, this is not a huge, pristine corner. We've got 90,000 square feet across the street, Antioch Publishing. We've got a huge, beautiful high school. We've got a middle school, which we have abandoned, but it's being used by the county. We have Antioch Midwest, which is only a third full, but Lord knows what's going to happen. Antioch University recently fired all 5 satellite presidents. They're bringing the whole thing under one umbrella for fundraising and so forth. So no one knows what's going to happen, but we all, if we could get a medical facility out there with good wages in this scientific community, who would be against it? Are we going to get an auto parts store? Are we going to get polluting noise? It would never happen. I know this council better. So I don't see anything insidious about the council talking about accepting a grant for utilities. Again, before I voted against bricks and mortar, because the plan was too nebulous. I didn't know what the hell could happen. This we understand. And if 260 will do it, then I say do it. I don't see a downsize anywhere. I really don't. So I am, if that's true, if this grant, if we don't get it, we lose it, then I say, that doesn't make real good business sense to me. I say, take it up. The only thing that bothers me is the estimates. I remember that at one time our new water treatment plant was going to cost under $3 million. And then it's 5.6. And then it went into 6. The Yellow Spring News maybe 6 weeks ago said, it's now 7.6, and we are not sure that will get it done. Now, I don't know where our engineering studies come from, but I hope the 260 is good. I hope the grant is good. I hope we get it done. But I don't see anything insidious or scheming or anything from this council about CBE. It is contentious, but I think developed with thought and foresight, it could be a boon to the town. It really could. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. And something I noticed, Bob was speaking very loud, was speaking into the microphone, and that really helped everybody be able to hear. So thanks, Bob. Dawn, I saw your hand go up.
Hi, I'm Dawn Johnson. I live at 234 North High Street.
Speak up.
Thanks.
Into the microphone.
First, I want to thank Jessica and her firm for their review of the initiative that Citizens put together. Secondly, upon your review, it makes me think, gee, have we been in violation all along then? Because you guys are just now getting to business on this. Perhaps not. I don't know. But what I do know is in my research, first thinking, gosh, we ought to start planning this, and then started looking at the existing plans on the books, the comprehensive plan, which was written in 2010, which was informed by the vision document that was also written in 2010, and then the data from the that informed the vision document. And this is what I got out of that. It was beautiful. I am so thrilled to live in a village that is so engaged in what happens here, because over almost 300 people came out for that visioning session. That's about 10%. That's pretty darn good in any community activity. But what they said was more interesting. And I don't know, it sort of boggles my mind how the comprehensive plan talks about this, a special district, the CBE, which, by the way, is on the deed to those documents. So until you vacate that plat, it's going to be called the CBE. But beyond that, what I found was this beautiful thing, and I want to thank my grandchildren also, because they helped me make this sweet little pie chart. 855 ideas came out of that, and about 100 some odd ideas talked about farmland being important to the village, and about 120 ideas talked about green space. And there were about 100 ideas, 120 ideas, something like that, that talked about business in general. But there were like 11 ideas that talked about the CBE. And also infill hit in there pretty good at about 40 ideas out of 155. But the ideas that talked about the CBE in a positive light, 3. Yet we get in our document that we need to develop out there. That's why I think we need the time to plan. And I really appreciate council hopefully stepping back, maybe moving forward and stepping back simultaneously, but this really should inform you. Look at the data. I don't know, I can tell you how, actually. The reason it got in there is the CBE got bundled with an idea of business. That's it. It's in that document. If you do a document search in your vision plan, it comes up one time. And it's in bundled together with 35 other dots that said, we need to enhance business. And that's the only place it shows up in the document. So please look at the documents. Invite us to participate. We'd love to participate again, I'm sure. And thank you for your time.
Thank you. Any other comments? Rick?
Yeah, I'm Rick Donahoe.
Close.
Closer?
Yes.
Yeah. How's this?
You can take it out and hold it, I think, actually.
That would take more than I'm capable of.
Yeah, good.
I feel like a rock star if I did that. Okay. Anyway, I'm against the, Mary and I have already signed the petition. Mary and I have signed the petition against, we want to put this thing on the ballot so that the whole village can decide. If this thing, if the putting the infrastructure out even that far, already we've seen where it potentially doubles the value of the land. Say if farmland is now worth at the most $10,000 an acre, Karen, I think you said yourself that if it goes out to the edge, your appraisal was what, $650 or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
So already it's doubled. And so that's only a part of what it'll be if you, you know, the next step for this is to go ahead and, put infrastructure throughout the 30 acres. That would be the next step. And wait and see what that land is worth then. And then you say it's all going to stop at the edge. But all small villages and towns have said that. And look what's happened to them in Beaver Creek and Fairborn. And every place has started small. And when you get enough money out there, things happen. When land gets up to $50,000, $100,000 an acre, things start to happen. And water gets pumped, sewage gets pumped, zoning gets changed. All kinds of things happen. So I guess all I'm saying is that if we go ahead with this, what seems like a very small step, $260,000, something like that. It's not that much money to pass up either. If we're passing up a chance to keep our town the way we want it to be, if we don't want to be like every other little town. And once you get that kind of money floating around out there, I think you can kiss the Jacoby Greenbelt goodbye, because you'll never be able to afford to buy it. I guess that's what I have to say. So, any questions?
No. Thanks, Rick.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Dino?
Hello, I'm Dino Pallotta. The nice thing about being in the village is that we're all a family. We all know one another. We all come together. And at times, you get disappointed when you see a lot of contention that's going on here. I want to apologize, extend apologize to you guys, because you guys have been taking a lot of heat. Apologize to everyone out here, as a village as a whole. We get a little uptight about this situation. The bottom line is, we're here for the good of the community, the good of the village, and that's the bottom line. What is going to be good for the village, and that's what we want to focus in on, and I hope we could do this in a spirited way, but in a way that we're not going to be mean-spirited, we're not going to be condescending to each other, just do it with respect and professionalism. Having said that, being in the corporate world, I've always been taught if you're going to come with a complaint or a problem, you better come with a solution when you're talking to your boss, or don't come at all. It appears that's what always happens to be on this issue, happens to be what continually goes on. We always want to stop, we don't want to make a decision, we want to hold back, and then the situation never gets any better. Having said that, we all know what's coming down the line with regards to utilities. We have another 30% increase coming on our water bills next year, 2017. After that, it's going to increase 2.25% thereafter. We have another 15% increase on our sewer bill next year, and that's going to go through 15% through 17, 2018, and 2019. And that's going to be followed up with a 3% increase every year. And then there's going to be nominal increases on our electric. So by standing pat and doing nothing at all, our costs to live here are ever increasing, as was stated several weeks ago by Ms. Johnston. We're no longer as affordable. We can't adequately welcome in diversity, first-time home buyers or renters. Each will have a more difficult time living here, all due to the lack of the affordability. If we continue down this road of inactivity, then we are on our way to becoming a bedroom community. That's not the path we want to choose. We're better than that, and we ask that we're looking to extend these utilities just so we can give us all a fair chance to live here. Thank you.
Thanks, Dino. Mm-hmm. Kate.
Kate Hamilton. I have one question on that. People keep bringing up utilities and water rates and things like that. If we were to have businesses out there, are we suddenly going to take back our 30% increase? How is that going to save us money? That doesn't make any sense to me. We're not going to suddenly have our utilities go backwards. The other thing I wanted to talk about, it kind of goes along with what Bill had said at the beginning. My main thing I wanted to talk about is a question of ethics. I was looking at the packet for tonight, and I noticed the notes from the Economic Sustainability Commission from June 1st. That's on page 138 of your packet. The CBE land is noted in there, and one of the bullet points say to create a marketing campaign, and it says in-house or using a commercial realtor. One of the things that I would like answered is I would like to know if you've talked to a realtor, if you have worked with a realtor, if you have an idea of who that realtor would be. Because you kind of connect the dots. Yeah, we all know each other. I get that. And for example, I didn't know that Dina was on the community, Community Resources Commission. So you kind of put the dots together. I mean, I live in Birch Three. I built a house there. How that land was taken care of is that there was a builder and a realtor, and they joined together as a team. So they're the ones that benefited from the sale of that land. My question is this going to be what happens here? And if so, I feel that that's a huge conflict of interest if, for example, Mr. Janelle was the builder. And I would like that to all be very public. Thank you.
Anything else, Chrissy?
I pretty much said everything I had to say about this lately in the letter to the paper this week. But I wanted to point out that the other day I was thinking kind of about this Antioch Midwest situation and about how they're talking about vacating that building. And thinking back on it, I was wondering, you know, why? Because they wouldn't have built that great big building and spent all that money if they hadn't thought it was going to be, you know, really necessary and a success. And I think that a big part of it was that that was a contentious thing as well. I've talked to people in the community about that, and it seems like people were very torn about whether or not that was a good idea to build that school out there or not. And so I feel like a lot of the community didn't throw their support behind it. And I just want to caution council that I'm not saying that you have to hear everything we say and let us help you make all the rules and the decisions. But in the long run, if you don't actually include the community in this decision, it doesn't matter what you build out there, it's not going to be a success. So that's
Thank
all.
Thank you. Anything else? Before we start talking about this specifically, my integrity has been impugned pretty intensely tonight. And I think if people go back and look at minutes, I recused myself every time my husband had any connection, whether it be a BZA appointment of which he's on the board. If there was a vote on somebody to join the BZA, I recused myself. I recused myself when he was involved with the CBE. I recused myself from every vote. I left the room. I was not involved. He is no longer and has not been involved with the CBE for years. And the minute when that changed, I got a legal opinion, and the attorney said I was allowed. There was no reason I couldn't make those decisions. The decisions on the library that were mentioned, I did not vote. I have not voted on anything to do with his contract, any work he has ever done with the village. And I am extremely, I've done this for 11 years. I have walked a lot of edges, and it has been very difficult, and I am very proud of how I've handled myself. I'm very proud of how I've handled the decisions, recusing myself when I needed to, and if somebody has something that they actually want to come forward, as Mary Ann said, and make a case, it would be good if somebody would actually do it in an official way instead of making suggestions and insinuations of something that they know nothing about. Okay. Sorry, guys.
I would like to just answer. I got one question out of, I've written down all the comments, but I did get the one question out of them was Kate had asked if we've talked to a realtor. Absolutely not. I mean, we're nowhere even remotely close to something like that. The fact that economic sustainability has discussed it, I mean, I'm sure they've discussed several other things that, before this even came up, they were talking about the CBE. But as far as any specific development plans for that piece of property, absolutely not. There's nothing specific. So, Don has certainly that.
We're done taking citizen comments for now.
I want to say, too, because I was on the council for 8 years with Karen before I came back on, and I've been impressed with how carefully she's walked that line, and she's, nobody had to encourage her to do that. She always did that. Because she wanted to do the right thing. And when you've got a husband who's involved in, does the work that he does, and he works here locally a lot, so there's going to be instances where Karen was not able to, and also as, being on the chamber, so she works here, and her husband works here, and there's that's going to happen. You're going to have these kind of conflicts, unless you want Ted to work in a different city or something, but
right.
That doesn't
live
really
local
make so
local.
Yeah, so it's, and I feel, and I just want to support Karen in the honesty with which she has tread that difficult sometimes line, and at the same time wanting to participate in these important discussions. So I guess what I want to say is that I've been leaning in the direction of thinking going ahead with this infrastructure was a good idea. But I feel like before we make a decision, I would like to just have a little, figure out a way to get more input. I know Krista's coming. I mean, I am concerned about that. It starts to get you a little worried because you see what happens in other communities. And it looks like once the economy starts to roll, I mean, we see the most ugliest development ever over, in the direction of Fairborn and Beaver Creek. And we just don't want to start something that we can't keep control of. So what linking this in some very specific way, I had suggested that council commit to putting monies from the Sutton Farm sale, should it go forward, with Glenn Helen, that would go into the green space fund. Because when I talked to Krista about preserving the Jacoby Greenbelt, but I didn't ask the question, is it going to be harder? I didn't ask her that question. Is it going to be harder if we have development getting a little closer to that undeveloped land? And it strikes me that there is that possibility, and I would like to be able to think, have better information on that. But in the end, one thing she did say is, and she's been thinking about how are we going to make that move if some of that land would go up for sale? How are we going to do that commitment of preserving the Jacoby Greenbelt? So one of the things is we got to have some money available. The village is going to have some money available. So I would like us to link, a commitment to funding the Green Space Fund. And if the agreement with Glen Helen doesn't go forward, then we're going to have to come up with some other, you know, I mean, that probably wouldn't even be enough in and of itself to get that fund healthy enough should something come up. So there's that. And then, and I guess that's my main concern, really. But I would like us to try to find some way of solidifying our commitment to that preservation.
Yeah, I think that's important. I something I've been talking to Patty about is starting some sort of a charrette process to talk about the property, to talk about ideas of what could happen there, which is what we've heard the community is wanting, that they're wanting a discussion about what could happen to that property, be it commercial development or something else, not wanting to go down the road of another paid consultant that may not know Yellow Springs or be familiar with Yellow Springs. A couple of the names that came up, one was John Young, our former assistant village manager, and the other is Ken LeBlanc, who is Green County Regional Planning. Both are certified planners, both know Yellow Springs, know the area. It wouldn't be free, but it certainly wouldn't, the cost wouldn't get to the point that that an independent contractor, an independent planning firm would cost. You know, having a number of sessions, different times of the day, different days of the week, to encourage as many people, different people, to participate as possible. It's Mary Ann?
Okay. Yeah. First of all, I guess I'd like to ask council, is there anyone on council who thinks the community should not be involved and not have input on this property that we've?
No.
Brian?
I think we've all said it pretty clearly.
Okay. I just want to be clear because it seems like this is about the biggest thing that people are concerned about, not being involved in the planning and thinking about this property. So just we go on record as every single council member wants the community to be involved in thinking, looking at, talking about, whatever words we want to use, and looking at this property that presumably is going to come into the village. And at that point, we can actually do it because it will be owned by the village. So I do support extending the utilities to that property, regardless of what happens, even if it were to stay a cornfield, because 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, things are going to change. And regardless of what people decide now, I, from my point of view, it's incumbent to take advantage of this opportunity and have it there, because then it is there for whatever happens. I would like to just echo what Judah said about Karen and Ted. I mean, the great thing about being able to live in Yellow Springs, ideally, is to be able to work here. We are really a bedroom community. Only 30% of us get to work here, which is one reason why it would be nice to have more business, diversified business opportunities for people who actually live here. But when you live in a small place, I mean, you know how it is. You end up having all sorts of multiple roles. And it really disturbs me the ease at which both rumors and suspicions start. Because truly, how could anyone get away with anything here? Really? I mean, we know everything about everybody. I mean, I think it would be really hard. So I totally support community involvement in looking at that property. I would like to see our Economic Sustainability Commission be involved in that and start thinking about how to get the community involved, probably looking at the documents for the previous plan. Is there something that can be saved or not saved? I've talked to John Gudgel with the mediation program. He is very willing to have the mediation program be involved in doing, if we do community forums and having facilitators. But there are all sorts of ways that the community can be involved. We can do online things where people, you know, who can't come to meetings can do online things. Whether we vote on something, at this point, I'm not clear, because to take advantage of business opportunities, there has to be a certain amount of nimbleness. And if we have a plan that is so set in stone and then we vote on it, I'm just not sure that, I mean, I'm not saying I would never support that, but I don't have clarity about that. And then the other thing is regarding the Jacoby Greenbelt and our urban service boundary. The urban service boundary defines the perimeter of the village, especially on the western side. And the way it defines it is because as the land goes down toward Jacoby Creek, it can't be served by our sewer system without having pumps to come up. And that, I'm not sure how long that service boundary has been in place, but it's been in place for a while. And I know clearly there are people in this room who are very afraid of sprawl moving out. And as Karen said, and I agree, I think more concerned about sprawl moving this way. But Yellow Springs isn't Beaver Creek, and it certainly isn't Fairborn. And look at how much energy we've put into saving, well, the Whitehall Farm, putting money. I mean, what other community puts money into a greenbelt fund and then gives it away to preserve farmland? I mean, I don't have such a concern about that, but I certainly do want to start putting money into preserving the Jacoby Greenbelt. And we've talked about how we might do that. So I'm done.
Excuse me. We're going to have a lot of discussion on what we're going to do with Area A, but it kind of concerns me when I look at an individual who stated that they have put 11 years into serving the village, okay, and all three times that they were elected, they were elected as either the top one or two individuals on the ballot, which gave them a four-year term. And when you make little innuendos or so forth, you're not just attacking one person. To me, you're attacking the whole council, which kind of offends me. Karen has served the community well for almost 12 years. And to have some remarks made as she is coming toward the end of her term is probably going to make her think, do I want to still continue to work and support the community? We as council members, we accept the role with very minimal pay, and we spend a lot of hours trying to make this community better. And, you know, to Karen, you know, I can't apologize for what might have been said today, but you have my support as a council member for as long as I'm on council, because I do understand the effort and the time that you put in to try to make this a better community.
Thanks, Jerry.
Hear. I guess I want to start with specific and then talk a little bit general. So first of all, in reference, since I'm the council liaison for the Economic Sustainability Commission, was at that meeting, these minutes summarize suggested goals for the commission. And if you do read in the packet, it says CBE land, if the land is donated to the village. And then it refers to some possible things that the ESC, the Economic Sustainability Commission, could do. And I do think those came out of, I know Marianne's mentioned it a couple times, maybe Judith as well, just sort of is this something that the commission could help with moving forward, to help think about that? So, you know, I mean, in terms of some ideas about what could be done, I mean, that again is not any intent of, you know, what's going to happen. These are recommendations from a commission. One thing that did was discussed at the last meeting, which I thought was good, and it relates to some things I heard, is similar to the HRC, which helped to facilitate community discussions about local policing. Does it make sense for the Economic Sustainability Commission to help facilitate those in partnership with village mediation to talk about developing the land? I think that's a great idea. I think this is part of what we have commissions for, is to brainstorm ideas, but by no means does this mean that anything was voted on. These are thoughts that they had. I guess I also want to again reiterate, and I've never heard a council member say anything against the idea of a public process on how we are going to develop that land, if in fact we are going to develop it. I think there, I mean, I don't want to be coy. I think that all council members have also reflected, and we have different ideas about it, that some development makes sense there. So, I mean, I think that's definitely out on the table. It doesn't mean that we won't listen to ideas of just leave the land there for its current use. But I think all council members have articulated ideas that they are thinking about contingent on that community process. I have been very clear from the beginning, and Bob Baldwin articulated my thoughts very well about where I see a grant being distinct from this bigger picture, and blurring those lines concerns me. I'm not going to say it was intentional, but I will say that conflating all these ideas and losing focus of what we're talking about, this is a step-by-step process. Transferring the property to the village, because it makes sense, we have the capacity to handle this process, and I think all citizens should want that. Making a decision about whether we use or lose a grant, at some point we have to decide whether we are going to lay those two pipes down and put in the stormwater or not. I have made it very clear, like Bob said, maybe not as direct or as colorful, but to me it's a no-brainer that that's something that we do, regardless of the bigger decision, which is how we develop it. But the last thing I guess I want to reiterate is I really appreciated Dino's comments about civility, because I do think it's starting to get out of hand, and it's part of what, I mean, it's basically what we see on the federal level, on the state level, and it's blurring the lines of proper decision-making for our village. And I think we have a responsibility as council members to think about the village as a whole. I loved what Kat said. But again, it doesn't mean I don't appreciate what all concerned citizens are thinking about here. I just think it's really problematic to take some of these smaller issues and again conflate them into something that is confusing everybody. I mean, I've heard so much misinformation just in this meeting, you know, about, you know, again, we're not talking about extending utilities into the property. It's one block. We're talking about very discrete things. I've learned a lot in this process for sure. You know, nothing is in fact a no-brainer. But that being said, I hope that we can kind of refocus the discussion, because council has made it very clear that we want public opinion. And again, as Bob Baldwin said, this council, and I don't believe future councils, are going to do anything that is not going to be fit with this community. Number one, you vote for us. Number two, as we've seen before, there are actions that citizens can take, like referendums, when they're not about something administrative, like making a decision about using a grant. And so I do think that there are plenty of protections, not to mention the covenants on the land, everything else. So I'm not worried about future councils and 3-2 votes and things changing, because there are plenty of checks on this process, as we've seen.
Thanks, Brian. So how do we want to end this discussion? We still do have a budget discussion to look at. How do we want to end this discussion this evening? Just move it on to the next agenda, where we'll have more time to consider the legal opinion to start with.
Are you suggesting just having it for discussion one more time?
Yeah.
I think that's a great idea. And I'd like to think about, we can talk about it, how to try to link it with a stronger plan about the Jacoby Greenbelt and getting that extra information.
We'll put those on the agenda. Yeah, we can put those. As far as I'm concerned, Krista coming, you talk about green space can be under old business because she comes so often. You know, it's a continuing discussion. So we can put those, you know, maybe perhaps even just put them together. Okay. We're ready to move on?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Melissa, you have a budget in front of you. We all have a budget in front of
us. I do. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm going to start out with just giving an overview of how I set this up, because I believe that this is Judith's first time with an actual budget presented by me. So the way that I have this presented is I have actuals from two previous years. I have 2014 and 2015 listed. I also list the 2016 budget that was approved by council. I have figures that are current actual expenditures and revenues as of the close of the month of August. And then I also have projections through the end of 2016. And then the very last column on the budget document is the 2017 budget. And then we have any notes that might be helpful. So I'm going to start out with the revenue side of this. And the revenues are broken into, six major categories. The first is local taxes, which include our real estate taxes, our kilowatt hour tax, and our city income tax are the three major players in the four lines. There's a personal property tax, which is very small. So the tax budget is where I get the real estate taxes, and they're usually right on target with what the county auditor gives us. So when we look at the 2016 projections, the actuals and the projections, they're pretty much right on what was budgeted, which was $910,000. We actually received $910,333. These are given to us first half and second half, so we get the first half right after January or so, and then we get the second half usually in July. So real estate taxes for 2017 are set to be $987,000, which is good. So that's about $77,000 more over what we collected in 16. The kilowatt hour tax.
Excuse me. Yeah. What's causing it to be so much higher?
I don't have any indication as to where, if it's any one particular property or chain of properties. They simply just give me the figure and I plug it in.
If you ask David Graham,
yeah,
do you
I
think
can,
he could tell you?
I can
mean,
probably
I am
try
interested.
To get some.
Is it more development or is it increased valuation?
Yeah, I can try to get some more detail for the next meeting
And it could maybe have something to do with DMS and improvement.
Well, that would be increased assessed value. That would be,
So yes, I'll definitely look into that. So when it comes to local taxes, we're going to bring in slightly more than what was budgeted this year, although at minimal, about $35,000. And then 2017, we've got budgeted for an increase in about $100,000 between the property taxes and small increase in income taxes, which have continued to go up, albeit slightly. So that's the main sources of revenue, which are the local taxes. So those are the main drivers of the general fund in terms of revenues. The second main section are the state shared taxes and permits. And I do have one correction to this, because we got When we get the first half and the second half taxes, they do have our state allotment included, but I don't post it until I actually receive the money from the state, and we received the second part of the rollback in Homestead just yesterday. It posted to the bank account, so I do need to update that. So that, if you look at that very bottom line, rollback Homestead, it is going to be closer to the $134,000 mark, which was projected. So I've got it listed as $101,004. So I do need to correct that, which will be a correction on the next budget when the general fund is presented again. So the rollback in Homestead is generally stable, and that's the biggest source of revenue there in that that grouping of revenues with the state shared taxes and permits. Intergovernmental aids and grants has been inactive. Usually those are YS Community Foundation grants that we get. We were employing a number of Miller Fellows, and this year we haven't had any Miller Fellows, so we haven't had any YS Community Foundation grant money come into those lines. Charges for service is an inactive line, as it has been for quite some time. Fines, costs, forfeitures, and permits. This is a direct, most of this is a direct result of the money that the mayor's court brings in. Fines and costs are the line that mayor's court comes into. So I had them budgeted at $20,000. They're on track to bring in about $21,500. So I'm going to keep those predictions steady for the 2017 year too. So that's a very small area of the revenue for general fund. The very last section, which is notable, is the miscellaneous receipts and reimbursements. This is kind of a catch-all for revenues. One of the big drivers of this 2016 year that was not predicted was some additional property sales that we received from Home Inc. from the Cemetery Street lots. That weren't necessarily the property sales aren't really something that I ever budget for, just because we never know when something like that's going to occur. It's very sporadic, and it's not something that we really, you know is going to happen ahead of time necessarily until the offer is presented. So in 2016 we were budgeted to receive $129,000, and we're projected to receive $191,000 as a result of those property sales. Another notable line within this is rent, where our cell tower rent comes in from the various cell towers that we have on village land. And then the cable franchise also comes into this as well, which I need to take a look at that again, because this year they kind of restructured their payments. So I need to re-verify that number, because I know that they were coming in at different intervals this year versus what they were previously. So I need to take a look at that. So with that being said, when we take a look at revenues, the 2016 budget, we were literally $40 shy of $3 million to be brought in. And the 2016 projection is $3,061,124. And the 2017 budget is just a little bit over $3.1 million, so going up ever so slightly, but that's a direct result of property taxes and income taxes. So does anybody have any questions about the revenue portion of this?
And you decided, just because of the uncertainty even at this point, to keep the Sutton Farm sale?
Yeah, I did. I kept that out of there. I have to revisit the revenues by recertifying them to the county, much like I do with the appropriations. It just doesn't have to come before council, so it's a really easy thing to update, but I did not include that in here, so I can always add that if we want to see what that does to our bottom line for the next presentation of the general fund. So I'm more than willing to do that, as long as we've got a good idea of what that might be.
Do we have a status on that?
Actually, I talked to Nick about that Friday night at the mm-hmm. auction, and you know, there was the problem with the appraiser because we had paid for the appraiser. So they contacted the appraiser that had done ours and asked him to do it, but then they were told by the state that they couldn't use that appraiser at all, and they had to mm-hmm. choose another appraiser. So now they're going to the other appraiser to target that. So it'll be a little bit behind schedule, but I still expect it to occur probably in January or February.
Okay.
I have one question. I know one of the concerns when the cable commission was active that cable franchise might go away. Are we talking about the same one that they had the concern about, or is this something different?
That is the same cable franchise, and from everything that we've gathered, we're not in any threat of losing that money. And it stayed relatively stable.
Okay.
So it hasn't been declining that much?
No, it hasn't.
Okay. Because that is attached to, obviously, users, because we get the 5%.
Mm-hmm. And again, I need to take a second look at what the projection is from this year, because like I said, I know that we've gotten them at different intervals this year than what we have in the past. So I need to make sure that's still an accurate projection. But with that being said, the budget is still a working document until it's passed an ordinance by council. So it'll be updated again for sure. Okay, so if everybody's ready, we can move on to expenditures. Okay, and normally when I've presented the budget in the past, I've condensed this so that you just see the bolded lines. So each of the departments within the general fund, they all have the same, it's usually six or seven lines within them. We have personnel services, which take care or address all of the wages and benefits for all of our employees. The second line is, general operating expenses, which is just simply travel and training. And then we have contractual services, which includes a number of things like the utilities that the village pays, professional services, any rents and leases, printing, advertising, hardware, software, and usually the most notable of those is legal services. And then there's also materials and supplies, which is very straightforward, office and operating supplies. And then there's capital. And then the last one is miscellaneous. So those are usually the same lines that you're going to see repeated throughout all of these budgets. So I'm going to quickly go through each of the departments, because one of the things that I would like to state before getting into too much detail with the expenditures is the last couple of years, we've taken a very conservative approach with all of our expenditures, and I'm very proud to say that this is another budget in which fiscal responsibility has been exercised. Once we get to the bottom line, you'll see just how much money we were able to shave yet again off this year. Each year it seems a difficult exercise when we take a look at the budget and where we might be able to trim, and every year we're able to take a little bit more off. So I'm really proud of the fact that this budget is a very lean budget, and it's not does not contain exorbitant costs by any means, but very modest costs. So when we look at council, we'll take a look at personnel services first. There's only $1,000 difference between what was budgeted in 2016 and what's budgeted in 2017. That's actually $1,000 decrease. With all of the personnel service budgets that you guys are going to look at, I went ahead and preloaded in a 3% cost of living increase. That's not to say that is going to be what may be suggested to council and maybe what ultimately ends up happening. I know that in previous years it's been anywhere between a 0.5% to 2%, I think, was the most, but I like to take a conservative approach when we look at the figures so that council has a little bit of wiggle room when we're taking a look at things like that in the future. So personnel services are down $1,000. General operating is the same that was budgeted in 2016. Contractual services, that budget was actually trimmed down by approximately $3,000. Materials and supplies was actually increased by a modest $250. And miscellaneous was increased where we had no budget previously to a $400 budget for refunds and reimbursements. So the total council budget for 2017 is $229,650, which is less than the 2016 budget. And if we look at the 2016 projected costs, we're projected to save approximately $33,000 from what was budgeted. So we'll go ahead and...
I have a question.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
And actually, I guess it's maybe more for council. But we've had discussions about having expenses for commissions and including them, I think, under council budget. And in this document, I noticed that HRC was singled out because mm-hmm. it has been. But I guess I'd like us to decide, and I think I support the idea of mm-hmm. having a budget item for all of the commissions as one.
Yeah, I mean, so let's go through. I mean, let's go through the budget, and maybe then we can talk about it when we're done, and the next iteration, the final kind of iteration that she brings.
Okay.
Judy, on the one number about books and publications, so I take it that that's what you send to American,
mm-hmm.
and you didn't. It's not going to happen this year. So it doesn't happen every year.
This year we actually got a new bound, very much more expensive.
So is that something that actually will need to be added to 2016?
It's gonna come. We've paid part of it.
Oh, okay.
So we didn't have it. Well, as of August 31st, I mean, there could have been a purchase order out there, but just no expense put against it. So if that's the case, then I just need to update that.
Okay. Nothing big. Okay.
Okay, the mayor is a very small budget. That department was budgeted at almost $49,500 for 2016, and it's going to come in just $200 more than what was budgeted, which is very minimal. And then everything else stayed the same with the mayor's court budget, except for the wages or the personnel services, which again I built in the same increase to that department as I have all of the departments. So their bottom line is $51,220. It's a very simple budget. Okay, administration. If we look at personnel services, in the supplemental appropriations, there were some part-time wages that weren't budgeted for, so those are incorporated into this budget. So it appears that there is an increase, but that was due to that oversight with the part-time wages. So I did budget for that in 2017 appropriately. So that was a difference of about $29,000 overall as it relates to personnel services. Travel and train or general operating expenses or travel and training remain the same. Contractual services, this is a significant area which a lot of expenditures tend to come out of because of the legal that comes out of here. There's also the RITA retainer, which is the monthly fee or the bi-monthly fee that we pay to RITA for administering our income taxes. So that's incorporated into here as well. So this is only a $1,000 increase over the 2016 budget. But keep in mind that when we talk about legal services, that those could change because I do know that that's kind of a moving target at times. So I try my best to just budget for the retainer, but sometimes there are increased costs above and beyond. Materials and supplies, that was actually shaved down a couple $100. The bottom line with administration, the budget for 2017 is $358,650. And that is all directly related to those increased personnel costs that were not budgeted for. Any questions about administration since that's a bit of a larger budget? No? Okay. Auditor, this is a very simple budget. This is what it costs to have our annual financial audit. It's also any fees that we pay to the Greene County Auditor for distributing our property taxes. So it's not a very big budget. It was budgeted for $32,800 for the year 2017, which is a little bit more than $2,000 over 2016, which is minimal. If we skip to rental property,
who does the audit again?
And you asked me, Julian Grube. I was going to say, you asked me very quickly. It's a 5-year contract,
and that they're recommended by the state.
What happened was the state will put out our audit externally every so often because they want to make sure that familiarity is removed from the process. So if, you know, the same state auditors keep coming in, I could get a relationship with them, and it could cause, you know, there to be some impartiality there. So we were up for our audit to go external. So we were able to actually look at lists of state recommended auditors, and we were able to actually, you know, gather references and select one. And so we'd selected Julian and Grube. This was our second audit with them, so we have three more years before the state could possibly take us back again.
And this was a choice by the state to have an outside auditor audit us. It wasn't our choice.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, they started it several years ago.
One of the claims I've seen is that we're somehow choosing intentionally to do an internal audit rather than have the state do it.
No.
The state actually, you give them the names of three firms, I think, and they actually choose one, or did they change that part?
There's a lot of it's been a while, but I know that there was scoring involved on both sides, so it had to be a mutually agreed upon firm that was selected.
Okay.
But I've been very happy with them. They've been really great to work for, and they shed a lot of light on things that I wasn't aware of before.
Wait, I didn't understand though. Why did the state want to do that?
Well, they do that with everybody because if the way that the state auditor's office is set up is they have different districts, so it's possible that we could end up with the same exact auditor or team of auditors assigned to us year after year after year. And if it's the same staff people working with the same auditors, you could begin to develop a relationship, and it's not an unbiased audit anymore. So they like to remove that from that. So that it's always a set of fresh eyes, at least regularly.
There's the risk of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's the risk.
Even when you contract with an outside firm, a private firm, you can only use that firm for so many years before you have to change again. So,
okay. Thank you.
Okay, if we look at rental property, this is a very small budget. This was only increased $400 over the previous year. This is basically the utilities and property taxes, in which we pay for the rental properties that we have that we actually receive money from, which is the train station. It's the utilities for that property, and I know that there's another one that I'm missing that is included in here too. Yeah, the library. Yep. So rental property was only up $400 from 2016. It wasn't the library. Well, part of the property taxes aren't even on the library.
The leases, the farming leases we pay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes, the farming leases that we pay, the property taxes coming out of there. I don't know why I was blanking on that one. Okay, so then the next one is the library.
I haven't heard about, I don't know what to call it now. I forget the name, but where Stutzman's used to be.
Stony Creek?
Mm-hmm.
Stony Creek.
Yeah, but I guess that would be
is
in
that
there
a
too.
Part of this
yes.
Also?
Mm-hmm. The property taxes that we pay on there. And any of the properties that we receive rent for, we have to pay property taxes on. So, like the Bryan Center, we don't have to pay property taxes on it because there's no rent involved in it. Okay, and the next one is the library. This was actually decreased a bit. The $5,500 is the typical budget that's usually allotted for the library. In 2016, it was a bit more because there was an improvement to the security system that occurred that was budgeted for, and was a one-time expense for that year. But there was nothing on the radar for 2017, so it remained the same, $5,500 as usual.
Mm-hmm. We will probably be looking at, when we do next year's budget, starting to put some things back in for 2018 and 19, though.
But are those in the actual, in this line item budget, or do they go into a capital? Would they go into the capital budget?
Yeah, they would be in the capital budget if there's anything allotted or planned for, correct. And we don't have the capital budget until, the next round of budgets, which would be the next meeting. The next department is cable TV. This is going to stay stable to the penny as far as we know. The majority of costs from here are for professional services, which pay for our contract employee. And we know that there are going to be certain upgrades that will be necessary now that we have the new technology firm or IT services firm involved. But we're still in the early stages of being able to identify what those needs are going to be, so we don't yet have figures for any of that. But we do have $10,500 in a capital budget for cable TV that's been untouched for years, so we can always take it from there if we need to. Okay, the next budget is human relations, which...
The cable TV,
mm-hmm.
Which is the contract for the station manager? Which line?
Professional services.
Okay, because it's listed down at the bottom of that.
Sometimes I make notes if there was a large jump from one year to another to just kind of indicate what that could have been.
I see. Okay.
Looking back at 2014.
Okay. Yeah, you can see where there was quite a bit of change.
Mm-hmm. And currently, the franchise fees more than cover for
absolutely
what we do with the station.
Yep, absolutely. We bring almost double in what our actual costs are. So,
mm-hmm.
Okay. The next department is human relations, which Marianne brought up. And when that conversation occurs, what I would recommend is just relabeling this council commissions instead of just having it earmarked simply for human relations. This is a relatively stable budget down to the penny. So. It's earmarked at $8,500 again in 2017, as was 2016, which is split up between a number of different things, special events, operating supplies, and travel and training for the most part. Okay, the next one, which is the one of the larger budgets, which is public safety. The wages are relatively stable. Again, I built in a 3% increase into that, which only affected the bottom line $4,000 overall, which brings personnel services to $1,205,634. And we have general operating expenses, the same budget as 2016, which is $10,000. And then we have contractual services. So this one, again, is a very large catch-all, like some of the others. But some of the costs that are included in this particular budget that aren't typical for other budgets, our Green Central 911 dispatch charges come out of here, which are budgeted at about $26,000 a year. We have, let's see, vehicle maintenance, which I know is going to need to be readdressed again. I know that there were some additional costs that didn't work its way into this budget. The police department also shares a portion of the retainer for the legal fees. They take 20% of that retainer included in this budget here. So their budget overall for contractual services was approximately $8,000 more than budgeted in 2016, and a lot of that is related to some of the hardware and software costs that they've had, which everybody had a lot of additional hardware and software costs this year with bringing on the new IT firm and some of the changes that have been made in the various departments. So their contractual services are budgeted for 2017 at $142,350. Materials and supplies are actually down $10,000 from what was budgeted in 2016. So those are $40,800, with the bulk of that being fuel costs and then some minimal operating supplies. There is a request for a new cruiser that has been incorporated into this budget. That was the only capital request that was made of the general fund. So there is a cruiser marked for $40,000, excuse me, in the capital equipment line. And so public safety's total budget is only $1,000 more than what it was budgeted in 2016, which is $1,438,784. Does anybody have any questions about police department?
That's more than $1,000, isn't it?
No, it was 1 million...
The 2016 budget.
Yeah, the 2016 budget.
Oh, the 2016, okay.
Mm-hmm. And I take a conservative approach with all of my budgets. I would rather budget more than budget not enough, so there's only a $1,000 difference, which is pretty good. And we'll move on to planning and zoning. If we look at personnel services, those expenditures are down approximately $6,000, even with the increase built in of 3%. General operating expenses is staying the same at $1,500. Contractual services, there's just a slight increase there, and it's kind of incremental across all of the lines, but $8,500 there. But if you look at the historical part of the contractual services, as you all remember, we used to pay Greene County Regional Planning for our planning, so there were some additional costs in previous years, so it is significantly less because we do have that in-house now with Denise Swinger. Materials and supplies is the exact same that was budgeted in 2016, so the bottom line there is a savings of approximately $4,000, bringing the 2017 budget to $62,144. Mediation, this one's easy. It's always the same budget. We haven't had any additional demand in that area, so we're budgeted again at $9,000, which is basically travel and training and professional services, which pay for our mediator services. So the total general fund expenditures before the transfers for 2017 are $2,242,799. So that's approximately $20,000 over budget from 2016. However, it is important to look at the projection for the end of 2016. We're going to have a savings of approximately $200,000 from what was budgeted, which is always a good thing to see. So those are the expenditures as they directly relate to the departments that the general fund supports. The very next section are the transfers out to other funds. The two main transfers out that we make every year are to streets and to parks, because those two special revenue funds only bring a minimal amount of revenue in, and it's not enough money to support those operations. With the streets, we get some money from some gasoline tax, motor vehicle registrations. So the rest of the money needed to support that operation comes from this transfer. So this year, we're going to be transferring out $236,204, which if you look at all of the years previous, that's significantly less. This is the smallest amount that we'll have to transfer out for the last 3 years, which I'm really happy about. And you'll see when I present the special revenue funds that the reason why that is that I only transfer out as much as we need, no more, no less, to keep those special revenue funds reserves where they should be, because it's easier to transfer money out than it is to try to bring it back in. So I transfer out the minimum that we need to be able to operate for the year. So that's what we're looking at for streets. For parks,
excuse me,
yeah,
I have a question. What about sidewalks? Is that included with streets?
Yes, sidewalks is included in streets.
So is there a $50,000 inclusion for sidewalks?
I need to look at that budget, since I don't have that one right in front of me. I think that's been continuous every year, so if that's been the same allotment, it's more than likely still in there.
My question on streets was, you know, we were spending this huge amounts on streets. Is this amount now going to be stable because we've gotten our streets into reasonably good shape? I mean, I don't know if you can speak to that.
Well, a lot. I can tell you that because I came in December of 2013, so these previous actuals, I've been able to be here to witness firsthand what those were. You know, what expenses were attributed to those amounts. And I can tell you that we'd been spending a lot in capital equipment in terms of different vehicles and pieces of equipment and such. So with the 2017 budget, I don't believe that there are any new pieces of equipment with streets. So that was a very big driver behind a lot of those, many of those bigger numbers in the past was capital purchases.
But are they
in streetscape? Streetscape was in there too.
The streets are on a rotating program. Mm-hmm. Jason has a list that he just works his way through that are, you know, we've done these five streets in 16, we're going to do these five streets in 17. He tries to get a certain number of miles.
So are we putting aside some capital monies for when those big pieces of equipment need to be replaced again, or is that?
Yes, and that's farther down in this transfers, the capital equipment line, which has been relatively inactive, that we're starting to put money in. So yes, that.
So we shouldn't be seeing those real high numbers.
I'm going to try to deter against that.
Yeah.
So
what we've been trying to do is get everyone to project 5 years in the future, so that if you need a new truck 3 years down the road, we know this coming and we can kind of
start putting money aside.
Yes, exactly.
We've also been much more diligent in requiring that the superintendents have maintenance records and that they can show that they're adequately taking care of equipment, to try to get the longest life out of them as possible too, versus not doing regular maintenance and asking for a new truck after 3 or 4 years.
Yes, thank you.
And then that also increases the value when we put it on eGov or however we sell that equipment. It increases the value if we have the maintenance records.
Yeah, that sounds great. Thank you for doing
that. Why do you have so much lower in the improvement funds than what you were doing in 2016?
That's where we put it to start. And there's still room for negotiation with that. We wanted to allot something, but, you know, it's all a matter of, you know, as we go along with this budget process and make tweaks and things, you know, just paying attention to that bottom line. So we allotted about 25% of what we had previously, just to show what that does to our bottom line. And as you can see, that the general fund for 2017 after the transfers will be in the black by $274,000. So we definitely have room to be able to make changes to those. But I wanted to put something in there, but maybe not necessarily the exact same amounts as 2016 until after we look at the special revenue funds, because if we make any tweaks to those, as it relates to streets and parks, that's going to directly affect this bottom line as well. So we have to keep those things in mind too. So when we go back for the final review of all of the budgets, we can take another look at that. But that's the same thing that we did with the green space and the three capital improvement funds, was we did about 25% of what we had just as a starting point.
Okay.
Well, so Melissa, I mean, is this an indicator that you think we should sort of be, I guess, putting money back into the general fund, or?
Well, you mean the general fund reserves? Is that?
Yeah.
I like to see, you know, our reserves definitely be above what the minimum reserve balance is, which mm-hmm. if you look at the very bottom of this sheet, I'm bracing for twice as much as what a lot of the government guidelines are, which is 4 years or 4 months. I'm sorry. So we really need to have $1,076,000 in reserves, and at the end of 2016, we should have $1,710,000. We definitely should be supporting some of those capital equipment funds and the facilities improvement funds, parks and rec improvement, all of those. We definitely should do that. But I just, with so many unexpected expenses as they come up, I want to just make sure that we have, I probably am way more conservative than what I probably should be. But, you know, like we've seen, there's unexpected things that come up that we just can't plan for sometimes, so I want to make sure that we have more than enough in our general fund to be able to support that, because general fund is the most important fund in terms of its flexibility. General fund monies can be used to support any other fund if they get into trouble. So it makes me very nervous to move too much money out of that and earmark it for other things in case we might need it somewhere else, because we might not have that flexibility if we tie it up other places.
Right.
Earlier, 2014, 2015, money was going into water and electric. Were those funds? Were we supplementing those funds?
What the electric one was the electric fund paid for the Bryan Center renovation bond. So we had a bond for the renovations for this building, and we refinanced it by allowing the electric fund to pay for the bond earlier, and then we just paid back the electric fund until that was complete, which 2016 was the very last payment for that. Water, now that was consulting fees from the water plant process. And I think that in 2014, I forget what the $155,000 was for, but I know for sure that the $225,000 was that was engineering.
It straddled years.
So the water fund, because we hadn't done rate increases, couldn't afford some of those preliminary costs for the water plant, so the general fund paid for it.
And then when do we discuss the green space fund and what we want to put in that?
Yeah, that's a separate fund, right? Is that in special revenue funds?
Yes,
so
it is.
We'll talk about it. When will we actually, Karen, you know, Mary Ann is asking about, you know, the commission, you know,
right.
We
can talk about that.
I'm just trying to understand the process.
The next meeting.
So are we just going to go over these first and then we'll go back through?
Oh, yes. Absolutely. So we're doing general fund tonight.
Actually,
and then,
that's the next meeting.
Yes, the very next meeting we do the special revenue funds.
And capital.
And capital. And then is it the next meeting we do enterprise? Enterprise is also the next meeting. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So then, you know, I'll present my preliminary budget, and then I will, you know, suggestions can be made tonight with the general fund, and suggestions can be made at the next meeting for those budgets, and then I'll incorporate any of those suggestions and then bring it before council one more time before it's approved. And then there's still time for discussion then before it actually comes as an ordinance.
So tonight, let's talk about the commissions. I mean, let's take a little bit of time since that's part of this general fund, rather than introduce that in one of the other discussions. So what were your thoughts, Mary Ann?
I don't have definite thoughts, but HRC had, I think at one time it had 10,000, now it's 8,500. And most of that, or a chunk of that anyway, goes to facilitate small grants to promote things that the village government supports but can't
process.
It's not going to do itself, so another little group will do it. So that's a little bit different than some of the other commissions, probably. But I guess I would think that each of the commissions maybe should have about 3,000 or so. I'm thinking of energy, environmental commission, economic sustainability commission.
Arts and culture.
I'm not considering planning in this.
Because they already have
the Justice System Task Force.
So that's...
The Justice System Task Force also could need some financing.
Let's say if there were five commissions that had 3,000 each, that would be 15,000. And then if we added on the HRC, what if we just said 25,000 for commissions?
Well, I have an additional question, because then one thing that was discussed at a previous council meeting was whether the centralized process, and if you were going to put all of the funding in one line for not only the commissions but also the council grants that you give and the other smaller projects, not necessarily infrastructure improvement projects, but the other smaller ones that are kind of noted in what I included in my packet.
I would suggest that we... Oh, so you think we should try to figure this out tonight?
Oh, I don't think we have to. Just, you know, throw it out there.
I think
I would have to understand what it was for, though, because you know, somebody brought up the idea of hiring a consultant. Let's say one of the commissions wanted a consultant for some reason. Well, a commission can't hire a consultant. Staff has to hire a consultant. So that would really be coming out of a different budget. So, I mean, if we give all of the commissions a budget, I would like to have some guidelines under which the funding is being used. And
well, I mean, what I've been talking about, and I still think it's really important, is that if commissions, I mean, I think we have that money allocated, but I think commissions need to come forward and provide a budget proposal. It'll be easy for HRC to do because they've got a lot of history behind that. And, you know, there are certain line items that, block parties, for example. And again, I don't think it needs to be, specific, like each thing, but this is going to go towards education, and this is going to go towards community forums. And I know for my commissions, that's what I've emphasized, is there should be some kind of proposal that is brought to council. And then I think that's a good way for us to kind of distinguish, if it's something like the consultant thing.
Right. So Melissa, how do you see this being administered, or just the paperwork? Does throwing it all into one bucket make sense to you?
I think throwing it all into one bucket does make sense, but the oversight part is the part that I think is going to need to be fleshed out. And as Patty was I think starting to point out, was just process, these funding requests, things like that, being just formal documentation of, this is what the commission would like to do. It's approved. It goes through the finance office for a check to be cut to wherever it needs to go. It's filed appropriately. We can track it.
For instance, one thing that has been brought up before is if the Energy Board wants to have John Courtney come to a meeting for some reason. Well, let's say they have $3,000 and it's going to cost $500 for John Courtney to come out here and do whatever. That means that we have to open a requisition for John Courtney. So their request has to go to somebody who can open a requisition.
In order to pay it.
How has it been done in the past?
They've asked me, and I've handled it and opened a requisition, but it usually comes out of my budget because they don't have one. So that just increases my professional services costs.
And that's kind of what HRC does now, is that they have a form that's filled out. Mm-hmm. It comes through the finance office, a requisition is opened, and the requisition is what triggers the check to be cut to wherever it needs to go.
Right. So let's just say we had a centralized process, and one thing that's been suggested before is that everything comes into my office, and I process them, and we put them in a report to council. But that way, if a requisition needs to be opened, it's my responsibility to open the requisition. And I can keep track of, or Melissa can keep track of, it goes into the comments, this is one's for HRC, this one's for Energy Board, this one's for Environmental mm-hmm. Commission. And let's say you tell Energy Board they have $3,000, they've spent $500 of it, they've got $2,500 left. If they try to overspend, then I'm gonna say, nope, you already spent your money.
Well, or, I mean, if there's a good reason, right. They could ask.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. That would be part of the process. Two things I like. I like the idea of a monthly report when we, report out on commissions, which I think would be easy enough to track. And, I mean, it does give us the ability to see how this is being allocated. Again, I think it's very important that commissions go through this process of sort of thinking about, what they need funding for. And to that extent, some kind of at least enough description that it is something that council feels comfortable with. And then I guess the other thing we have talked about is, does this all come under that community development funding heading or something like that? But I do agree, I think Judith has said this, that commissions could be broken out and then, as kind of like a sub account, and then maybe another account is, if we are going to continue with the process of nonprofits being able to come to us for requests, right, there's got to be some kind of account for that, too.
I mean, you could call it special funding or, whatever, and then just have a line for commissions and a line for economic development and a line for mm-hmm. you know, the council grants or whatever, but I think keeping it all in one place makes it easier mm-hmm. for Melissa mm-hmm. to track.
I just have one question. You know, we're talking about commission, you know, and I'm looking at HRC where it's projected that they will spend about $3,100, if I'm reading that correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they've only spent $2,000 so far.
And they've only spent, they're in the last quarter.
Jerry, I will say that one thing that they normally do is sponsor some of the trips for the school kids. They make arrangements to sponsor some of the trips that the kids that can't afford it.
It's the eighth grade trip.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, but still, it's close. You know.
Right.
You know, we're looking at almost 4,000 hours.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And then we want, if we stayed under the old plan, we'd be looking at a budget of $8,500 for the following year. Mm-hmm. This, you know, which kind of makes me want to go along with the fact, you know, a pot mm-hmm. that covers all commissions and that you look at, you know.
I think if we're going to mess with HRC's mm-hmm. budget, significantly, we want their input. Mm-hmm. Is one thought. Is one thing. Mm-hmm. I think we should hear from them about that. But I like the idea of maybe just having a. I mean, they may have more because what they're doing is a little different. But like Environmental Commission might ask for John Courtney to come. But they're not going to, you know, they're not funding these other things mm-hmm. in the community, which HRC is doing.
Oh, no, I'm just looking at what they've spent.
Yeah, no, I see what you're saying. And I don't know if they're, I would want to hear from them. Did they?
Some of the usual requests haven't come in or haven't come in yet.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, it just seems, you know.
Yeah, but that is the purpose of the budget request from the commissions.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, it's just to be thoughtful about it, you know, not just, I mean, what, 3,000, 8,500, they're all arbitrary numbers until we...
But do you want to budget, if you want to budget at the beginning of the year, then you're really asking the commissions to think about how to spend some money. Mm-hmm. And they may have no wish to, it may have it, you know, nothing...
Well, it can always come later.
It can mm-hmm. come later.
Right, it can come any time, right? We have that 25,000, 30,000, you know.
So it would be individual requests they might make. Right.
That could happen too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And I don't want to get into a big discussion about this, but I don't have a problem with suggesting to commissions that they do give grants, that they maybe that's something that they consider, that the Energy Board would consider giving some kind of an energy grant, or that Environmental Commission consider giving some kind of a grant. Again, you know, I don't want to talk about it, but I think it's something to think about.
We will actually...
I don't think it needs to be just with HRC.
We will actually, when Judith gives a committee report, be talking about Efficiency Smart and what to do with that. That mm-hmm. may become something grant. So
okay.
That's true.
Yep.
Okay, so I think... So it sounds like what I'm hearing at this point is when we come back, we'll have $25,000. It'll be council commissions. We'll have $25,000 in that budget.
And then I do want to just underscore the reporting thing, because one of the concerns I always have is that we get minutes several months after, so we really have no idea what's going on. So just some kind of simple. And Melissa, I already know you already have the format anyway, so...
Okay.
I was going to suggest, Ms. Chai has been waiting patiently, I think, for the discussion from Patty. Are we moving on?
Yeah, we're ready. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was just thinking, you know, when...
about the...
When
talk about the stop
when
sign.
Citizens bring petitions, we might want to put it on our agenda earlier, because to wait for the end of the meeting is long.
Yeah.
In the future.
I guess it could, maybe we could have done it. We should have done it during citizens' concerns.
We could have done it there, or old business.
Yeah.
Even. But anyway, just a comment, just because.
So
you've been very patient.
Yeah, thank you. So we'll move on to manager report.
And this is covered in my report. Chaya had brought a petition about moving the stop signs, and the petition requested that the stop signs be placed at Davis Street. Chief Hale sat out there for several mornings, and he didn't notice any vehicles that were traveling at excessive speed, but he says he, although he hasn't noticed it, the petition does reference a segment of High Street between West South College and Limestone, which is five blocks, and there is no stop sign in that entire five blocks, and it is kind of just a straight shot. So it wouldn't be hard to imagine that someone would not be paying attention because they're going down a long straight stretch. His suggestion was to place the north-south stop signs at Whiteman instead of Davis because it breaks up that five-block stretch a little bit better instead of having them back-to-back at Limestone and then Davis. Chief, am I saying this correctly?
Yep, that's correct.
And so that would be the chief's recommendation, is if you want to have the stop signs, then that you should place them at Whiteman instead of at the Davis intersection, but that it might not be a bad idea to put another set of stop signs there.
I mean, and that's what we're similar to what we were talking about doing on Livermore,
right,
is to break up a long stretch to do
correct
some moving or addition, just to break up a long stretch of road that
that's
people
correct
can speed on.
Mm-hmm. So if council would like to add stop signs there, it will have to be an ordinance, and we will have to bring that ordinance. It'll go through two readings, and it'll be 30 days after that, which will be sometime in the middle of the winter when the ground is frozen, but we'll get them in there.
Thank you.
If we can.
Thank
so
you.
So if that is what council would like to do, I can bring an ordinance to the next meeting.
All right. Let's support that.
That makes sense to me.
It makes sense.
Thank you, Council.
You're welcome.
Thank you
for your patience.
And for bringing it to our attention.
Yes. I'm trying to get back to there we go. Okay. So the bicycle pilot project, the Bicycle Corral pilot project that is on Short Street at Xenia, hasn't been incredibly heavily used, but it has been used, and I do notice a few more bikes there every time I go by. We were hoping to meet today with Chris Bongiorno and Eric Oberg to discuss another location over on Xenia in the part that has, it's not a parking space, it's actually the yellow curved section there to the north of the north crosswalk in front of Unfinished Creations. And so unfortunately, Jason was not at work today, and so we've had to reschedule that potentially for tomorrow. What we may like to do, we think it might get a little bit more use even, plus it would give us the parking space back, is once ODOT goes through, we would like council to consider allowing us to move that pilot project over to Xenia, and then make the parking space on Xenia, or on Short Street, a parking space again. The only concern that we have is to make sure that there's enough clearance coming around the little crosswalk sign that people don't come into the bike corral. So that's what we were going to meet about today, but unfortunately didn't get to. So how does council feel about potentially moving that over to Xenia Avenue once the paving is done?
Or have we talked to the businesses at that
we haven't talked
location
to the,
on Xenia Avenue?
We haven't talked to them yet. We wanted to make sure that we could actually fit it in there safely first.
And what type of
It will be four of the loop things. You can actually buy a kit that comes with the bumpers that go along the edges. Yes,
mm-hmm.
To keep you know, cars from running into the cyclists.
I have a picture of a similar situation that I saw in Ann Arbor that I'll send to you.
Yeah.
They just had some nice signage on it.
Yeah.
That might be helpful too.
This is actually a kit that was suggested to us by Chris Bongiorno.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing is, you know, I love the high school's got a couple of these, the Yellow Springs branded,
mm-hmm.
you know, reverse use.
We have one of those out front, and they don't really like it very much because it doesn't pull the bicycles up, I'm told. But
Yeah, maybe it has. I think Xenia did a really nice job with just the simple X, and there's plenty of space to park your bike.
Yeah, this kit has four of the just upside-down U spaces where you can put a bicycle on each side, so it would essentially would hold eight bicycles.
And we actually have two of those already on Short Street, right?
We do, but we would be probably removing them.
And I mean the two upside-down U's that are blocking in the longer bike rack?
Yes, but if we move it, if we move the pilot project over to Xenia, we would actually be making that a parking space again. So
no, that's what I'm saying, but we already have two of those that are on Short Street,
so
we've got some extra ones.
You know, I've got a concern here. I drove down Xenia Avenue and two people were, they just got out of the cars and walked across the street.
Mm-hmm.
They walked behind cars, behind trucks. They just walked across the street. And now we're looking at, you know, we got bike racks now on Short, if I understand you.
Mm-hmm.
We want to move those to Xenia Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's we're at possibly adding more pedestrians to a main thoroughfare, you know. And we understand it as Yellow Springs citizens, but, you know, we're getting more and more traffic that they don't understand that. You know, I'd rather give up the parking space on Short Street versus adding more congestion and, you know, the possibility. Because it's tough enough now for a bike in a car, and it's even tougher if you got a semi coming, plus you got someone walking out in the street. I'm just not comfortable with putting more, like I said, I'd rather lose the parking space versus putting more congestion on Xenia Avenue.
Is the loading of the bike, it seems to me, in the bike rack that I saw in Ann Arbor, the barrier was on the traffic side.
Correct.
And so you would load the bike in from the sidewalk side.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Well,
that's
no, you can get in.
But you're not getting in from the traffic side. I mean, people are not accessing it from the traffic side.
They would be able to, yes.
Well, but Karen's talking about, so again, you haven't seen this visual, but it blocks on three sides. So you can only pull the bikes in from the front sidewalk.
That's not what the kid that Chris
said. Right, but we could.
Well, but we don't have to do exactly what this kit.
I understand. I'm just saying that's, I wasn't thinking of that because that's not what
I think Jerry makes a really good point. I saw, Dave, do you have any statistics? How often are there car doors get taken off? Do people, I saw a truck that literally took up the whole thing. I mean, it seems like we're getting a lot more wide loads down Xenia Avenue.
I prepared absolutely nothing. I know we've had some car doors. We actually lost a cruiser door about a year and a half ago. So it does happen, but it's not, I'm thinking like maybe three. We've had side swipes, but when actually hitting a door, I think like two in 2 years.
Right. And injuries? I mean, I think we'd probably know about that.
Yeah.
Fairly minor. The speed is slow enough, you know, and most people stop and let people through downtown. They just let them jaywalk. So.
Mm-hmm. Is, we had talked about, I think, in the past, having the walkway across from where everybody walks, which is the driveway along Tom's there. I mean, that's a big, busy pedestrian crosswalk right there where there's no actual crosswalk. And then, so that's one question. I know we've talked about it, and I don't know why we couldn't move it.
I don't think anybody wants to do that.
Nobody wants to do that. Well, and then the second question I had is, can the speed, what is it down there, 25?
Yes.
Can it be reduced? In that block, can we reduce it to 2?
I don't know.
It's a state
route.
I don't know that it's.
If we said there was a
if we pass a complete street policy, there are plenty of villages that have 20 mile an hour, and that cuts the risk of injury a lot, just that 5 miles. So it
just is possible. That, it's just that block, really. It's just, well, you know where it is.
And
it's like two blocks.
The thing about the speed limits in town is most people actually go 20, most people drive 5 to 7 over the speed limit where they go. There's 55 people are driving 62, 65.
Right.
Downtown,
people are driving slow.
20 to 25 miles an hour.
Being slower.
So right.
I think that's one reason we've had very, very, very few, you know, injury crashes or pedestrians drunk.
And on the weekend days when there's a ton of pedestrians, people are driving even slower. They're barely, you know, they're driving really slow. But I wonder, if we could, we might want to think about that, Brian, because I do think it does feel sometimes like when you're getting out of your car, if you're right downtown and those big trucks are coming by.
Yeah, I mean.
You feel a little bit like you got to watch.
Yeah, I mean, between Limestone and Dayton Street, where Dayton Street ends, potentially even Cemetery, because, you know, where Peaches, that area in front of Peaches and Bentinos, that is really busy there, too. Mm-hmm. So I would say definitely down to Dayton Street.
Yeah, and around the school. Yeah, I mean, you know, the statistic that is... I mean, I think it's, you know, it's out there. It's is that at 20 miles an hour, if you get hit, there's a 5% risk of injury. At 25, it's 40%. So it really, I mean, it's amazing how much it jumps.
So it seems like on this issue, and one last, well, I assume you're going to address, are you going to say something about 68?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's just, you know, you'll meet with these guys. I think just bring it back to the next meeting and kind of report on what.
And I do want to just add one more thing about congestion, because I think it's a really important point that Eric and Chris have made, is, you know, for every bike on one of those racks, that's one less car coming downtown. So, you know, there are congestion issues. I agree with Jerry that we need to think about, but also if we can promote less cars coming downtown, like that's amazing.
As Brian noted, the new playground equipment is in. They are working on getting the mulch in there right now. They work today and probably will finish it up tomorrow, and we will have a ribbon cutting there next Wednesday, the 28th, at 3:00 in the afternoon. The groundbreaking ceremony for the water plant is this coming Thursday at 11:00. As Karen just noted, Barrett Paving started last night and tonight doing the full depth repairs on Xenia, and they also are tonight supposed to start at Young's and work their way south, paving all the way down through the village, down to from one county line to the other. So for those of you who are here, if you have to go that way, go on home, choose an alternate route, because they were putting the cones out when I came in.
I have a question. So I live close to Xenia Avenue, and last night it sounded like there were like a dozen jets coming into town and landing one after the other.
Yep.
So the neighborhood came out to look, you know, and they're digging these large pieces down a foot or so.
Yep.
So the word on the street was that there were old railroad ties there.
That is correct, and that's where you see all those sinkholes.
It was a trolley.
Streetcar
trolley kind of system.
Huh.
Yep. Yeah, that's what causes most of our sinkhole problems down Xenia, is the old railroad ties.
Boy, it'll be so nice to have those fixed.
So
they're doing
the full depth repairs, and then they'll come through and pave it. And boy howdy, if you think it was loud last night, wait till you hear that milling machine going. But
are they gonna do that in the middle of the night?
They
too?
Are gonna do it at night, yeah, because of traffic. So so we already talked about Chief Hale's memo on the stop signs. Included in the packets is the list of special funding that council requested, just kind of a recap. And actually, it's in there kind of twice. I think I sent something to Judy originally, and then I sent her a combined document, and they all got in there. But it's all the same information. And this is just because council had expressed an interest in seeing the different events and what each of them might cost, et cetera. And because we were going to have a fuller discussion on how things were going to be funded. So I don't know that we necessarily want to go over all that now. It was more just an informational thing for everyone.
Thanks for putting it together.
Mm-hmm. As Brian said, a reminder that the free food bank truck is out front of the Bryan Center the fourth Tuesday of every month from 1 to 2. Trick or treat will be on the 31st from 6 to 8. And I think I've said this before, but as long as I am here, Trick or Treat will be on the 31st from 6 to 8.
Why is that?
Well, because it's
traditional.
There's been a movement in the last 10 years to try to get everybody to have it on the same day and the same time, and that keeps folks from going from point A to point B and kids getting like 10 bags worth of candy. And so it is recommended by most of the managers associations and administrators associations that you try to keep it on the 31st from 6 to 8. And so that is what we will do.
And that seemed to happen last year. Last year seemed to be the first year that everybody was doing that. Previously, they all tended to go more on the weekends, and I was so glad to see that happen.
Yeah, it's actually been the recommendation for like the last 8 or 10 years that to try to get everybody to do it on the same day, and we hope that we're moving in that direction.
And on the homepage of the website, can we add an R to Trick?
Oh, yes. Is it?
It's Tick or Treat now.
Okay. I didn't put it up there. Ruth Ann must have gotten happy fingers.
Do we advertise outside of Yellow Springs?
We do not.
We don't. I don't.
Because when you live near Xenia Avenue, I mean, most of the people we get are out of town. Yeah. Get many more people from out of town,
nice town to walk
than
in.
From Yellow Springs.
Yeah. No, we don't.
I guess it's because people think it's safe and, well, maybe they think we're more generous. But
yeah.
I mean, you know, I sort of appreciate that, but it's really nice to be able to.
No, we do not advertise anywhere other than on our homepage and our Facebook page is the only place that we actually put it. But
are we still doing the hot dogs and?
Yes, we still do the bonfires with the hot dogs and the cider and that. So hopefully everybody will be happy with the 31st. And once again, the Planning and Zoning Office will be closed for most of the month of December. And that's all I have.
Melissa?
Business as usual. It's just the budget. That's it.
Budget.
Business
Judy?
As usual. It's just minutes and meeting packets.
Oh, okay. And I got
okay.
to get you a different.
So let's go through. Let's see. I think Planning Commission is first.
We did have the two items related to vacating, you know, the alleys and planning. That's planned. I'm looking at the alleys as a whole. To kind of help the niece along. They also had a discussion, I think the, what was it, the B&Bs after I left?
Airbnbs.
Airbnbs. And did you also
the
have
neighborhoods.
Did you also have the pocket neighborhood discussion? Did you get to that?
Very briefly.
Very briefly.
Yeah. But,
what was the upshot of the discussion about Airbnb?
That it was a difficult discussion and needed more information.
Okay.
There was not any hard and fast conclusion. Gather more information, go look at what county regulations are.
Because what's on the table is whether you need to request a conditional use, is that right? Or that's not, we're not even there? Or?
No, not even, no. Mm. No, it wasn't.
No.
Okay.
It was just something that Denise has been researching and so forth. And,
A formal B&B, if somebody, you know, Bob Sweeney did come to Planning Commission and get a conditional use permit for his facilities. He would be considered a more traditional full-time lodging place where I think Airbnb is typically occasional. You would think it as a little bit more occasional than
short-term.
Short-term. Well, they're all short-term,
but
it's not happening every night of the week.
Right.
Where Bob Sweeney could have somebody sitting at Jailhouse Suites every night of the week. He hopes he has somebody at Jailhouse Suites every night of the week.
Right. But when it does happen, it requires parking.
Right. Right.
Well. I mean, I have done a short-term stay place, and I do have to say that the way we have it in our zoning code is incorrect, because a short-term stay place can be one night, two nights, a month, but it's listed as a week. So that's incorrect, and I just sort of gave up on trying. And I also rent out a bedroom on Airbnb. So I have experience doing both of those things. But Airbnb is a way of, you could rent out an apartment, you could rent out a bedroom, you could rent out a house on Airbnb or VRBO. But
I think the issue, as Brian said, I mean, the issue is parking, and I think potentially disclosure to the neighbors, you know, so that neighbors know that there are people, you know, who's kind of a coming and going kind of place. And I think that's why it's a conditional use. That's why at least the lodging that we have now is considered a conditional use. We didn't address, I don't think Airbnb existed even when we did the zoning code.
Oh, yes, it did.
Well, we didn't, we ignored it then.
Airbnb is a way to advertise a room or
a short-term stay.
A short-term stay. Yeah. It's just, it's not anything different than a short-term stay. It's just a way to advertise a short-term stay.
The upshot was another discussion before there's a public hearing about anything. So there's going to be another discussion at the next Planning Commission meeting and then potentially a public hearing on the issue the following.
Okay.
Next is Finance Committee report. I think we know what's going on with that. Community resources from Brian. I don't think we have much to say about that. Economic Sustainability Commission, Brian.
Yeah, so the Economic Sustainability Commission is focused on reviving the revolving loan fund. So that was the focus of our last meeting, which was just to look at, we had a program in the past, so do we need to revise those criteria and whatnot? Any of that would come to council, of course. But the other thing that the group has been researching is funds from the USDA, for example, that could add more money to that fund. So still a lot to be worked on, but that is the focus of the ESC right now.
Arts and Culture?
The Arts and Culture Commission, and this actually, I'll kind of bring this over to the Community Access Panel, which has been on hiatus. The Arts and Culture Commission is now down to 4 members, so I do want to keep on putting it out there that, you know, because this is a commission actually that does a lot of work and is really excited. For example, one of the things that came up was a new sign that I'll mention in a minute. But it occurred to me that maybe one way to make sure we don't lose that interest is if those commissions don't have the minimum number, they could still be advisory. And I think that is kind of what happened with Community Access Panel. Those folks are part of your advisory committee for the fiber. And similarly, the Arts and Culture Commission, we're not taking minutes, but I think they can advise for things like the new Bryan Center sign that we're talking about.
Right.
So I don't know that we need to formalize that, but I just wanted to throw that out there, that I think that's still a way to keep those citizens interested.
So does the commission, we leave it as a commission of the council, but it's just, I mean, does...
Yeah, maybe they just kind of go into this, you know, they could advise still council or the village manager
without making any changes on the legislation.
Exactly.
I mean, I would prefer that too.
Right.
Personally. And then if something big comes up and there's more interest in people,
right,
then it can go to become an official.
Yeah, because, you know, I think we've seen that waxing and waning with a lot of commissions.
Yep. Yep.
And in particular, what has come up with the Arts and Culture Commission is Patty and Jason asked the group to put together a call to artists for a new Bryan Center sign, which had been in the works. And so they did a great job putting that together, and they're also interested in helping to review those proposals when they come in. And so we will be letting out that call to artists as soon as Jason reviews it, and that'll go on our website, our Facebook page. And but yeah, that's a great example to me of using that expertise.
And Crystal also has been working with us on
Right, because we're going to do a smaller sign for the John Bryan Community Pottery.
Great. Judith, Energy Board?
The Energy Board is recommending, I mean, we had a meeting, we talked about a few different things, but the one thing was the Efficiency Smart Program, and the recommendation is that we drop out of that program. And Patty was suggesting. I mean, that money, it's $40,000, so it's a chunk of money. And so the request of council that we help, that we try to think about helping citizens reduce their utility bills and how that money could be used, I think there, that would be a good piece of money to try to use in that way.
Right, mm-hmm. And I do have to let AMP know by the end of the week.
By the end of the week?
Or we automatically renew.
Okay, well, I will add, I mean, to this discussion, you know, I know that the Little Art, when they changed out all the marquee light bulbs to LED, mm-hmm. I mean, they spent 6 months trying to get Efficiency Smart to support that, which is, I think, what this program is about. Mm-hmm. And it all came down to, because their two providers didn't have the marquee light bulb, they said no. So all this time was wasted. And ultimately, Little Art still did it. But I mean, if those kinds of things aren't being supported by the program, I definitely agree.
Yeah. So do we need to make a decision, official decision right now?
I think it needs to be a motion of council, yeah. Because it's been a discussion for several, well, at least since I've been here on the Energy Board, that this program isn't really providing a lot of benefit to the community.
Yeah, there was a feeling if we had more industry, maybe it would mm-hmm. be more worthwhile.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, my understanding is they've gotten all the low-hanging fruit,
right.
And mm-hmm. there just isn't enough new construction. There isn't enough big industry to take advantage of it.
So I guess I'll make a motion that we cancel our contract.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. And we began, I mean, Patty and I were talking to them about, you know, thinking about, and there were already some interesting ideas coming up about the kind of ways that we could help citizens reduce their utility bills. And then Library Commission, we didn't meet this last month, did we? The Library Commission mainly is just trying to, you know, keep the village to remember the repairs that have been agreed to, that they be done. And I know we're kind of waiting for staff, for things to slow down for the staff so they can get through those things. Justice System Task Force had their first meeting, and it was a very good meeting. People introduced themselves to each other. We've broken into small groups just for people to get to know each other a little better, discuss the resolution that set up the committee, and so that people can, you know, make sure they're clear about what the charge is and have a little conversation and bring back their thinking from that. So, and Judy came and talked to us about, what did you talk to us about?
Sunshine.
Sunshine. Something.
So anyway, so that was the first meeting.
Okay.
I wasn't sure where to add this, but it's most relevant to the task force. You remember we had the letter from the group that was sort of put together by Pastor Randolph?
Oh, I was thinking we need to write a letter acknowledging that letter,
yeah.
I think.
And among those citizens, one of them mentioned to me that they would love, and so Chief, this is actually maybe something I wanted you to hear in particular, is could there be some kind of presentation about what people should do when they are stopped? And we had talked about this. It's come up before. And we had even talked about, you know, it's a presentation that could be videoed. It could be put on Channel 5. But, you know, for our youth, I mean, it may be something where it's convening high schoolers and giving this presentation, just what are the proper things to do. But video that for anybody in the community that's interested. So I thought that was a great idea, and I wanted to put that out there.
Did you... Chief, didn't you do something like that similarly down at the high school at one point?
Yeah, I mean, there was talk of doing it and seeing if someone from the ACLU actually wanted to go. The ACLU puts out very good information on this. And from a police standpoint, it makes perfect sense. So you'd be happy to go over it or give a presentation or Channel 5 or whatever
needed. Right, and it might just be easier so you don't have to just stand in front of the camera to actually, you know, gather a group of students. So,
although, I mean, if there are videos out there, I mean, it might be do we need to reproduce something that's already?
If they're out there.
Yeah, I mean, if the ACLU has videos, I would be surprised if they didn't.
Yeah, and I've definitely seen PDFs of points and this kind of stuff, but I'll search a little further in the election.
I think there's something, I will say though, maybe something to be said for our own chief doing it.
Yeah.
And borrowing from those best practices, but.
Well, you could maybe film him doing it with a group.
Right, that's what I'm thinking.
Having a conversation with the group.
Exactly.
Where are we? Mary Ann Village Mediation.
Let's see, I did go to the mediation program. I'm not recalling, I didn't look that up in my book. I don't recall anything in particular, but as I mentioned, I have talked to the mediation board and to John Gudgell about helping to facilitate a forum or whatever kind of processes we decide to use regarding economic development and property A, is that what we're calling it? Property A? So that's that. Shall I go through my other
things? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So the Environmental Commission continuing to work on the grant for the Glass Farm Wetlands. Well, you know that Dewar had come to our last meeting talking about the climate action plan, so that's working on that. I'll talk about the ordinance in a minute. We're doing work, especially Patty and Jessica have been doing work on the wellhead protection plan, and we plan to do education in the community about that. And Nadia Malarkey had been working on organic lawn care workshop, and there were more things in the work about that. So this ordinance that you have in your packet is being recommended by the Environmental Commission, and I just wanted people to see it and the basic difference between the current ordinance and the revised ordinance is, one, there's a longer list of invasive species that, in this case, primarily it says owners are strongly advised to consider environmentally friendly management plan for removal of species, and there's a long list of those. And then there's an addition to, which is number four, about a managed natural landscape, which would enable people to grow, whether it's tall grasses or whatever it is that they're growing, if they're doing it using native plants and it's an intentional planting. And then an omission of the clause that delays mowing from until July 1, and just struck out.
So then that means the default would be the height at that point, right? Once it reaches the, what is it, 12 inches or something?
Within 5 feet.
Right. So, Marianne, where is the, when you said strongly advised, I didn't see that.
We're under two, number two, it says owners are strongly advised to.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. It got bled into the other
invasive
stuff.
Invasive species that are to remove, to have a management plan to remove these species, and these are species listed by the Ohio Department of Natural Resources.
Okay, so the only other one we're sort of requiring is the
purple
loose strife.
I would just change these letters instead of having it start with F. I would go back.
That's why I got confused, actually.
Back to A. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Why is purple loosestrife required? Is it required?
I don't know.
It is. I mean, Regional Planning, when Tamara, for every subdivision, she says purple loosestrife, no purple loosestrife, and no calorie bears. That's in every subdivision.
What?
Approval.
Why? I just don't know.
I guess it's just an invasive. It's that usually it's because it's not controlled and that it could be. I don't know if it's from, you know, if it's not native, I'm assuming it's not native.
I know, but there's all these other ones that are separated out, that's why I was wondering.
Why some are advised and the other is...
It just must be worse.
I know, for example, I know why poison ivy is...
I don't know what it is.
I was wondering if there was something...
Some of them, purple loosestrife takes over just about everything. That wherever it goes, it takes over everything. And some invasive species, they just, you know, you can find them here and there. But purple loosestrife will actually choke out cattails. It gets that bad.
Is it that purple flower?
It's a big, tall, long, thin thing. It's got a columnar thing of blooms along the top.
It's pretty, but...
It's really pretty, but it chokes out everything.
And were calorie pairs purposely left out since that was brought up? I mean,
I don't know.
Because we have done an awful lot of removal.
Yes, we've been removing them on the glass.
Yeah, that probably would be a good one to add.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this looks good to me. I mean, I think that the normal process is that something like this goes before Planning Commission. Were you just looking for some kind of go-ahead from us?
Yeah, I wanted council to see this before. And so shall we just send it to Planning Commission?
Yeah, I think it looks good.
Mm-hmm.
And I will we have our meeting tomorrow, so I'll ask about the calorie pairs before doing that.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, they have completely taken over the corner of Trabine in New Germany, Trabine. Mm-hmm. 5 acres full of those things.
Yeah.
You're right. Yeah. That back
Way
to the
yeah.
Okay.
Do you want to say something?
I have.
Your C should be 6.
C should be 6.
The last one.
Yeah, you're right. Right down here.
6. Okay. I met with Steve Kahn from the school board. And talk to him about, you know, what's happening at council. Of course, the school continues to be interested in broadband, also interested in the potential development of the CBE, I mean, probably as a positive thing, safe routes to school. And he talked about the fact that, I guess, both of the school buildings are old, especially the high school, and the school board is starting to look at how to handle that, whether to rehab school buildings, build new school buildings, use an existing new building that might be vacated. So an open enrollment is 25% of the school population.
Well,
did he say what it was, the population?
No. He did say that there are an increased number of young families in
the system. Definitely see that.
Yeah, because we have about, well, I know there's 600-ish at Mills Lawn, so.
600 children?
Yeah.
Really?
That seems high.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
From what it has.
Classes are expanding.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Okay, and then HRC. A good portion of HRC was spent with our own chief police, and some of the people that had been involved in writing the letter that came to council were at that meeting, and so HRC has started a new process, and I'm saying this for the newspaper as well, of inviting an officer to come the first 20 minutes, I think, of HRC, so that if citizens want to have an opportunity to meet an officer and have a sort of informal exchange, find out about who that person is, maybe ask questions, not so much bring up issues with the police, but really relationship building, that they can do that. And so Chief Hale talked about himself and you know, his background, and then everyone in the room talked a bit. I thought it was a good conversation. And one suggestion that came out of one of the people in attendance, and I don't know how it would work, but would be to have photographs of our officers somewhere available in the Bryan Center. And actually, I was thinking, if we did something like that, have photographs of all the village staff. Somewhere.
We have them.
Right. Well, the idea was to attach names to all of them, too.
Yeah.
That had been brought up on the website.
Mm-hmm. So I would like to mention that the letter that was written by the that went to HRC.
Yeah.
I mean, I was named in it, and I was very confused because it was not something I was aware of. So, I mean, I do feel like there needs to be a response, but I don't feel like I have the knowledge to be able to respond to it, even though I was the person representing mm-hmm. council that was named. Had you prepared any kind of a response, or is that?
That's what I have just been thinking, that we should probably, somebody needs to respond, and I mean, I would be happy or do you think HRC should?
Well, yeah, maybe, I think so.
Since they brought it to HRC.
HRC.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
that makes mm-hmm. sense.
Okay, good.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Are you done? Go ahead.
That was another example where Reverend Randolph was here, and, you know, we never actually talked about the letter, or he didn't get a chance to speak to it. I don't know. I was just thinking when people do that, I think he came maybe that he wanted to speak to it a little bit. So I just wanted us to be more aware when we get those kind of things from citizens.
Mm-hmm. If somebody knows who somebody is sitting there, I mean, I didn't
okay.
know either
yeah.
of these two
sorry
people.
Sorry about that. And, yeah, it just and it occurred to me partway through the meeting, and yeah.
I can't ask everybody in the, you know, if they have something to say.
We yeah, and I thought about that afterwards too.
I mean, I was just trying to figure out a way to invite that if someone sends us something, and
right.
I didn't obviously figure.
I
it out.
I will say I would normally think about doing that, but we had. So many letters.
Yeah.
I remember just going through like 20 of them and not even looking up. So, but
and that's actually
true.
A process, Judith. If you remember that we actually talked about how we pulled back. That's something we did. Is that we were spending meetings responding to all of our petitions and communications during the meeting, and we really worked to try to find a way to be more effective. By responding later or by turning something over to staff, by having a response which would be to turn it over to staff or to turn it over to HRC or something in that regard. Now, if somebody's here, you know, that would be a time of, you know, that would be a good citizens' concern opportunity.
If it's not on the agenda.
Right, if it's not on the agenda.
Know, we could say,
yeah.
you know, did you want to speak to your letter or something
mm-hmm.
like that? Okay.
Or we could add them under old business.
I think we need to be very careful about not just adding petitions and communications when we immediately get them. I think that has to be a decision of council as to how we respond
yeah, that's
to
true.
Those.
Very good point. Mm-hmm. Okay. No, I just noticed it and then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Marianne, are you done?
I'm done.
Okay. So Greene County Regional Planning Commission, subdivisions everywhere, Sugar Creek Township, I don't know when they're ever going to stop growing. There is something that might be of some interest to us. The state passed an agritourism bill. Basically, it was pushed through by the Farm Bureau, and a lot of townships aren't very happy about it, that you can really 5 acres if like 25% of a 5 acre parcel is agriculture, then there are all these things. You could be a bed and breakfast, you could have weddings, you can you can't be a bed and breakfast, but you can have weddings, you can have events, you could be Young's Dairy, you could bring the public in. I mean, it's really could change the face of things for townships in the kind of ATV. Somebody could have an ATV park in the middle of the township. So it's really kind of interesting. Most of them are really opposed to it. There's probably not a lot of revenue coming to them from it, and they see it as being a regulatory issue. So
who sees it that way?
The township officials.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission has honestly been really quiet. Probably the biggest thing is the Route 35 Super Street. The hope for years has been to take it totally offline, to have it totally like an interstate with off ramps and on ramps and things, and that's
hundreds of millions of dollars. It's just not going to happen anytime soon. So the solution, it's about a $5 million solution, I think, which is pretty reasonable, is to keep everything on the same level, but you can't make left-hand turns on. So from Alpha, Orchard Lane, and there's two or three streets along there that you won't be able to make a left-hand turn at the traffic light. You'll make right-hand turns, and then you'll do a U-turn. I know it sounds really strange.
Where is this at?
In Beaver Creek. It's the only section of 35 that isn't interstate, that isn't restricted access. It's on-street access with traffic lights. It's very dangerous. There have been a lot of accidents. The traffic is horrible. So that's the big project. I think it seems like a pretty good solution. Chamber, just working on, obviously, street fair coming up, and just a lot of other events. Fall is really the busiest time of year in Yellow Springs because there's just a lot of events, one right after the other in the fall. And that's it. Future agenda items. So we've got the big thing is the budget, enterprise, special revenue, and capital funds. During announcements, we'll have Marty Heidi from Mike Turner's office. She'll just take a couple of minutes to talk about passports and response to the heroin epidemic. Krista will come so we can talk a little bit about how we want that. She said she was available. So if we want to just have a single item under old business about development east of development and land use west of Enon Road, something like that. We'll talk about it at agenda planning, but it seems to make sense to put those two together. And then Marianne wanted to talk about alleys. It seems like it should be a pretty light agenda, so it seems like that wouldn't be a bad place to put it. Then the 17th, another budget workshop. That will also be commission reports. And finishing out the budget in the next two meetings after that. Anything else that you know coming up legislation-wise or anything?
Stop sign.
The stop sign, so that will come at some point.
I did think the budget presentation was very easy to follow.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Thank
yes,
you.
Thank you, Melissa. So we do have should be a brief executive session scheduled for the purpose of the discussion of compensation of a public official. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Judy, would you please call the roll?
Jerry.
Who seconded?
McQueen. Marianne.
Winthrop?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Howard?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Templey?
Yes.